When you're here, you're family, but once you're in the parking lot, it's acceptable to kiss with tongue. Welcome to Comedy Bang Bang. Shampoodler!
Catchphrase superstar! Again.
You're a catchphrase superstar!
Going through the stratosphere to catchphrase heaven!
Or hell!
Catchphrase God!
Oh! 19 Comedy Bang Bangs in the Comedy Bang Bang theme song. I counted them today.
Sorry, gotta stop you right there and say I thought it was 14.
It was 19.
The Hardcastle? I thought it was 14.
No.
Here, let's listen to it again. Here we go.
All right.
And let's count them off. Okay. Here we go. Engineer Cody. Okay, none so far. One, two, three,
four,
five,
six,
seven,
eight,
nine, 10,
11,
12,
13, 14,
19. Oh, you got it right at the end.
You really
pulled it out. You did it. Paul was right, 19.
How did I hear?
You were counting on, first of all, we were both counting.
Yes.
But we were counting on one hand, and it is easy to lose track. 14 and 19, it's the same finger. You hold up. You just can't remember how many you've rolled through.
When counting on one hand, it is easy to lose track.
So. I'm sorry.
an apology so soon.
Apology tour 2016.
Victory tour. Let's do a victory tour.
Oh, gosh.
We should go back to all the cities we went to on tour and say thank you.
What if the Jacksons, remember when they did their victory tour back in 1985?
Yeah, yeah.
What if they had just done Trump speeches and Trump? I don't know how that would work.
If they just rambled, just like, it's great. Jackson 5 is going to be great again.
Lock her up.
That was fun for a while. We don't do that anymore.
No. You got me on my knees.
State of shock.
Please, baby, please.
The greatest Jackson 5 song.
I actually love that song. That is
State
the
of
greatest.
Shock?
Yeah. I mean, it's the greatest Jackson song.
Is it the Jacksons or is it just Michael Jackson with
It was the Jacksons
McJagger.
With Mick Jagger. And the Jackson 5 had, of course, great songs like ABC and I Want You Back and all that. But then they changed their name to the Jacksons and they put out maybe 4 or 5 records or so.
Why did they change the name to the Jacksons? Was it to accommodate additional Jacksons or
I think someone had a bun in the oven that they were hoping for. And then I believe there was a miscarriage and they were like, you know what?
Oh.
We're stuck with it all.
So it was going to be the original Jackson 5 and a baby.
Yeah. I love that movie.
A newborn infant. That movie, the original Jackson 5 and a baby. And then remember, they thought the set was haunted, but it was a cutout of Tito.
Welcome to Comedy Bang Bang. And you are listening on
a very auspicious day for you.
You are. What an episode to be your first episode, if it is indeed your first episode, because this is the Best of Comedy Bang Bang 2016, episode 1.
Trude at.
We're doing 4 episodes of our Best Ofs. We're counting down what the listeners of this show, super fans of this show, voted in as their favorite episodes.
Or people who hate the show and are trying to destroy the system.
It's like the American Idol where they were trying to vote for Sanjaya.
Sanjaya!
One of these episodes may be the Sanjaya episode. I'll let you tell me which one you think it is. Hint, Solo Bolo may be coming up.
People love this Solo
Bolo.
They
do. As do I. By the way, my name is Scott Aukerman. I'm the host of Comedy Bang Bang every single week. Which wasn't always the case. There have been some substitute hosts over the years.
Been a long time since that happened.
Been a long time. Been a long time. Been a long, lonely, 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 lonely time.
Since you've had a guest host.
Mm-hmm. Since we've had a guest host.
20 years ago. When did do 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 do
I see Darth Vader over there. This is Rogue One.
Forrest Whitaker.
Welcome. Across from me, of course, joining me for the 25th year in a row.
That's right.
On the best ofs, the only episodes he ever does. He is right across from me, Mr. Paul F. Tompkins.
That's right. Reaching across the aisle.
Finally.
In the spirit of bipartisanship.
meaning we're two different people. Is that what bipartisanship means to you?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay, that's then every interaction would be bipartisan.
Good, it should be.
I wonder what year this is that we've done this together. It might be literally our eighth time doing it together.
It might be.
I don't really know. But
how old is the show?
It's our eighth anniversary, and this is our eighth best of, I believe. So
that's pretty cocky. That first year,
we had a
we should do a best of.
No, it was like it was like an 8 month period from May to December.
So not even a full year.
Not even a full year.
And you were saying people got to vote on their favorite episodes.
But at the same time, we were, you know, it was one of those things where we were taking a couple weeks off from the radio station. And so it was a banked episode. So we said, let's do a best of. Come on. I have to explain this to you, Mr. Okay. Showbiz.
It's for the benefit of the listener.
Being for the benefit
of the listener. What is that?
I started that and realized that song has no discernible melody. Being for the benefit of Mr. Kite. I don't even know.
For the benefit of Mr. Kite, there will be a show tonight on trampoline.
But they never say being. That's the problem.
No.
In the lyrics, they do on the title of the song.
Exactly.
If it's going to be in the title, put it in the lyrics. If it's going to be in the title, put it in the lyrics. That's a new one. Paul, 2016, people are calling it the Peter O'Toole special, my favorite year.
For the podcast.
Yeah, no, for life.
Not, oh boy.
But personally for you, how was your year?
Personally, it was a great year.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
did you get a little closer to your wife?
No, we stayed the same distance. That's why it was so great.
Emotionally.
If we're going to be together forever.
It's got to be incremental.
Absolutely.
Otherwise.
So, yeah, sometimes she'll ask me a question and I'll be like, let's save it.
Yeah, let's save it for 2025.
Better not tell you now. Reply hazy, try again. I'm a magic eight ball. Mm-hmm. I don't know if the listener knows that. If you don't know what I look like.
Yes, if you're listening, Paul is a magic eight ball.
I'm round and black. I have a little window in me.
So like Cedric the Entertainer in a way.
Cedric. Cedric Yarborough is the only Cedric.
He's the only Cedric. So sorry, Cedric Yarborough.
Cedric was on my podcast, Spontaneity Nation, mm-hmm. where he revealed.
He's the greatest.
He's a dream.
He frequently on the Comedy Bang Bang TV show had a recurring role as a sportscaster. They were so funny doing this sportscaster Kyle Bornheimer. They were so funny together that I said, I need them back just like. So
we have to invent a reason.
Any excuse we had, we would put them back into the scripts and they would very nicely show up.
Cedric is so funny and so nice and so much fun to be around. But he revealed that
but
he
you said he's very nice, so fun to be around, but
he killed my dad.
What? He did?
No, it was vehicular manslaughter. Okay. It was not on purpose.
Oh, no.
It's like, I can't fault him for it.
It's manslaughter, though? Manslaughter implies that it's on purpose.
Vehicular manslaughter.
Sure, yeah. No, whatever, vehicular, non-vehicular, manslaughter implies intent.
No, I don't think so. Manslaughter means you killed someone. It does not mean, murder means you did it on purpose.
But you're at fault.
It's not
somehow.
Manslaughter, she wrote.
That's a good spin-off.
She just investigated accidental
manslaughter's
deaths.
Oh, Jessica.
You didn't realize the glass had a sliver of broken
when you like served it to them. It.
Oh. I think there's been a manslaughter here.
And by the way, person slaughter.
Yeah, you know right, what I mean? 2016.
Come on, 26, almost 2017, and it's not person slaughter yet?
This is 2016, going on 2017. What were you going to sing?
I don't even know. I was saying almost 2017, but you said going on, which makes more sense because of the original song says going on.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So for you, for you personally, good year for yes. the world.
It was tough.
It gets worse and worse, doesn't it? Yeah, just like every year worse.
Those videos that they show to kids.
Which videos?
It gets worse and worse.
it gets worse, kids.
Yeah, you have your experience of like, I thought things were bad, and then they got even worse.
Yep. But, you know, we're not here to dwell on that necessarily, but
let's celebrate the good stuff, because there were many good things. And I will say, for such a challenging year, I laughed a lot this year.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. There was some sad things that happened, but I realized, I must admit, when I look back, mm-hmm. I had a lot of fun this year.
As did I. Some terrible things happened to me personally. Someone on the internet said I wasn't funny.
What?
Who?
Yeah. Oh, I know that guy.
Yeah, do you know that guy?
I think he said that about me, too.
White Genocide 666? He's got a little frog. He looks like a frog. He's a green frog.
Wait, not Pepe.
Yeah, Pepe.
Pepe?
Wait, is his name Pepe?
Pepe the frog.
Pepe le frog?
Pepe is the frog.
Pepe le frog.
Do you think that...
Emetanol.
White... What?
Emetanol.
Emetanol. Is that frog?
That's frog for... Hey, wait a minute.
Oh, you're speaking in the frog language.
I'm speaking frog French.
Oh, I see. Mm-hmm. What do American frogs sound like?
Ribbit.
That's an answer.
That's an answer. What were you going to say about...
Do you think that the neo-Nazis mm-hmm. took that Pepe drawing and adopted it because it's such a shitty drawing that's easy to replicate?
I can't tell. No one seems to know. I've read article. If you don't know what we're talking about, there is a cartoon of a frog that was on Reddit and similar places that was not associated with white supremacy at all.
Nope.
And somehow they took it over.
Yeah.
And now when you see it, and it's too bad because the creator of it has no connection to that at all. It would almost be as if like Walt Disney created Mickey Mouse and within like 3 months, someone was like, hey, guess what? This is a Nazi symbol. And then Disneyland would never have happened. We're now in an alternate reality where Pepe the Frog Land will never happen because of this.
Never have Pepe rides.
I want a Pepe ride.
I want to eat Pepe pancakes.
Pee-pee-pees?
Pepe!
Oh, Pepe!
Okay, lost.
But no one knows how it happened, though. It's very weird. I don't know, like, what the first guy to do it was like, hey, check this out. This really says what we're all about.
But Pepe was a popular meme before it became adopted
popular
by
meme
the-
that was sort of like about anti-establishment, maybe, in a way of like, hey, like, fuck you, maybe.
I'm as cool as this crudely drawn frog.
Yeah, or like, you know, there'd be a lot of pictures of him, you know, like flipping someone off or something like that. And that's like, hey, Pepe. And I guess like the ultimate anti-establishment is the alt-right.
We don't like this establishment that allows different races to walk around freely.
Guys, we're getting political here. Normally, we don't do it, but you know, it's the world we live in. And what are we going to ignore it?
It's inescapable this year,
you know. But they say laughter is the best medicine. And that's what I was going to talk about. Some terrible things happened this year, and just not only personally, but in the world. But we did laugh aloft. We laughed a lot, and we put out a lot of product, a lot of tent.
We slung a lot of tent.
So much content. Oh. 20 episodes of Bang Bang. You put out 18 episodes of Bajillion, and
that's right.
You did so many live shows. We did so many live shows together as well, but you did your Largo live shows and a lot of tent out there. And hopefully that, you know, we've talked about it on the show before, you know, you can't just like turn off wanting to laugh, right? You know?
Can't you?
I don't know. Can you?
I mean, if you're on the game show, Make Me Laugh.
That is a great time to be able to do it if you can, but a lot of people can't. Otherwise... You know, they would have to give away cars every single contestant, you know?
Do they give away cars on
the
show?
I don't know.
I think that's
I want to say it was like
$50.
Generous.
Yeah. I think it was a dollar a second you didn't laugh.
Right. Did you? Were you ever on it? Were you ever
a person?
Yes, yeah, I did like three episodes.
Yeah. It was mortifying.
I thought it was really fun because I had just started comedy and I did three episodes.
Sure.
And I felt I was in that like, oh, I don't know my place in the world and a lot of people I look up to do it. And it would be so cool if I got to do it. And we went and auditioned and the producer came over and I was like, so what do you think? He's like, oh, yeah, I mean, you guys are great. And the rest of these people fucking suck. Wow. It's like, oh, geez.
Wow.
But that was like such a nice, I had just started comedy and for a person to go, oh, you're so much better than everyone else was like, oh, I got, and the cool. First TV shows I believe I did were Make Me Laugh, three episodes of Make Me Laugh.
Were
the first time
on
camera, I believe.
You were on Days of Our Lives for eight seasons.
Sure.
You don't count that?
No, I walked right from my final episode of Make Me Laugh into the Days of Our Lives studio by accident.
Oh, I see.
I was wearing an eye patch.
Sure.
And we all know that villains wear eye patches,
that's
of course.
Right.
And they said, whoa, get over here for a second.
Snitches get stitches, villains wear eye patches. Mm-hmm.
And I was Paige for the next eight seasons. Yeah. So anyway, that's a little bit of trivia about
me.
Fun
story.
Now, Paul, what we're going to do on this episode—
break it down for me.
—is we are going to be counting down the top 15 regular Comedy Bang Bang episodes of the year— and the top four will play one every episode of the Comedy Bang Bang live tour episodes.
You're including live episodes.
I'm including live episodes. Now, those, normally I would include them in the regular voting, but because not everyone has Howl, not everyone has a Howl subscription.
Those episodes are behind the paywall.
Oh, God. So that's so frightening, Paul. Don't say that. Not everyone has been able to hear those, so we want to give people a taste, but also they naturally get lighter votes, so I wanted to honor those because the tour was, I think, some of the best episodes we did all year.
Agreed.
So I want to make sure people hear some of them. So we'll be hearing one of those for each of the these four best of episodes, and we're counting down the top 15, and you voted for them.
You. This is on you.
This is on you. We have no horse in this race.
Yeah.
We have no skin in this game.
I don't care. I don't care what people thought were their favorite episodes.
I don't care at all.
I don't care. I don't give a shit about what people think.
They're wrong.
What they do, what they say.
Wait a minute.
I don't care if they're alive.
Well, hold on. Are you like a nihilist?
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't care about Earth.
Oh, you don't care about Earth?
No.
Even.
Dirt, grass, forget it.
Yeah. The very,
that's plants,
what makes up the Earth.
Dirt, trees,
and grass. Yeah, all of that.
Rocks.
No, you can stop.
I don't care.
We all know. Lava?
Minerals? Lava?
Magma?
Magma? Shmagma?
Shmagma. we're going to do the... this particular episode, by the way, we're going to be counting down number 15, number 14, number 13, and number 12.
Mm.
So...
four regular eps and then one live.
The fourth live episode.
I see.
So if you're just listening to this one, we're going to get better and better each one. So make sure that you listen all the way
according to
the fourth episode. According to you people. Oh, you can't say you people. Dwayne The Rock Johnson.
Hashtag it.
So keep listening to these because if you like this one, it just gets better and better and better and better and better.
If you like the worst one, you'll be like... I'm dumb.
If you're dumb enough to like these shitty episodes.
If you're such a brainless moron that you listen to this last one and you're like, that was pretty good.
I enjoyed all that.
Bill.
Ding, 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 ding.
I swallowed my fork again. I forget what's food and what's not.
358th time this year.
How did I even count that high? I'm dumb, get it?
If you're one of those mindless cretins, then continue listening because you'll enjoy it.
Yes, exactly.
There's
hope for you.
There is hope. And speaking of hope, I hope to get to our first clip right now. What do you say?
Oh. I thought when you said...
Speaking of hope, that I was going to talk about Barack Obama's campaign.
Yeah. And then segue into Star Wars Episode 4, A New Hope.
A New Hope, of course. And Rogue One is out now. So
subtitle?
Subtitle.
A Star Wars Story.
Is it? Oh, okay. Normally, the subtitle is the what we call them, as in, you know,
exactly.
Empire Strikes Back and
Star
all that.
Wars, Rogue One.
So why don't we then, okay, since we call, you know, Return of the Jedi, all that, why don't we call this A Star Wars Story instead of Rogue One, like colloquially?
So is, okay.
You know what I mean?
Right, because we using say Star Wars. Formula. Did you see Star Wars?
Yeah.
People didn't say, did you see The Force Awakens?
Right.
You know what I mean? They said, did you see Star Wars?
Okay, well, that's different than what I was saying. I was saying people said, did you see Empire Strikes Back? Did you see Return of the Jedi?
Yeah, yeah.
Star Wars is the only one that we actually say instead of A New Hope. A New Hope is a terrible title for a film.
But I think we say it is terrible.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's time we relitigated that.
Okay.
Bad idea. Poorly executed.
Calling it that?
Yeah.
Well, it was never supposed to be the title of the film. Here's the problem. They called it Star
That's
Wars.
That's right.
They just called it Star Wars. When That's it came right. out, it was just Star Wars.
Yeah.
And then in the crawl, they were like, oh, we got to have a title for this dumb chapter. It's not the title of the film, certainly. We would work harder on this.
Yeah.
So George Lucas is just locust, right?
George Lopez was like, hey, let me get in on this.
offensive?
What?
And not even good.
He's a person.
He's a person? Wait, is that the bare minimum? You were going to say he's a person? That's the bare minimum for an impression for you. Is that if it sounds like a person?
That's
okay, you succeeded on that front. It does sound like a person. Let me take umbrage with the dialect.
I was like, when I was doing it, I was like, wait, what does he sound like? I know that.
Has it been so long that we've forgotten what George Lopez sounds like?
I was trying to think in my mind, like, what's a typical thing that he does in his act?
Mm-hmm. And you came up with.
I tell you what, though, there's definitely video of George Lopez in some bit going,
that's the
hey!
Thing. Stereotypes are true. Anyway, I was going to say New Hope. Yeah, George Lopez just wrote down a New Hope. Like, who cares? First thought, best thought.
Well,
and now, because there were more than one Star Wars film, he has to now call it a New Hope.
But for some, I remember even as a kid reading an interview, and it was something to do with when he and Spielberg were kids, and they would see these chapter plays or whatever.
Right.
And
jerk each other off.
I think he just... They'd sit there.
Mr. Steven, come over here.
Yeah. They'd sit. Oh, that's... You mimed something different than you said.
Well, no. Well, I had to make the noise with my mouth. I couldn't actually do it with my hand.
But then you were pointing your hand. What are you doing? Yeah. I'm glad the listener can't see this. Scott.
I'm the noise I'm making. Yes, it sounds like a blowjob, but it also sounds like someone put lotion in their hand.
That's
and they
what
are,
I was thinking.
Oh, what were you thinking?
Never mind.
Wait. What? Wait.
No,
what
it doesn't matter.
Paul, tell me. Let's not have an argument about this. Just explain your feelings.
I thought you were eating a Wendy's Frosty.
Oh, you thought I was eating a Wendy's Frosty.
I thought you were eating a Wendy's Frosty. Yeah. You're like really scooping it in.
You've
super
seen
fast.
Me eat before. Is that how I sound when I eat?
I never look. Now, you and I have eaten meals together.
Sure, and you're wearing a sleep mask.
I always put on a sleep mask.
But you're able to hear it.
And I can hear it.
So that's what I sound like.
That's what you sound like.
Okay.
Yeah.
Got it.
We always eat at Wendy's.
Well, every
you
day.
You always order a Frosty.
I never eat regular protein.
Scott and I have a standing luncheon date. We eat at Wendy's.
It's like Carl Reiner and Mel Brooks.
That's right.
Every single day we get together for lunch at Wendy's, put on our sleep masks, and eat ice cream.
Oh, you wear one too.
Of course, you've never been able to see, but
I
slip one on.
No, because I have my sleep mask. You wait until after I put mine on.
I know.
A gentleman.
I do. After you, I always say, and you don't know what that's referring to.
I don't.
Well, now you do, jackass.
You got me.
Anyway, I was going to say that we call them Empire Strikes Back. You don't call it Star Wars.
But I think when the new one comes out, you refer to it as Star Wars.
Yes. I didn't call it. You're right. The Force Awakens.
It's when you're talking about them
Which
in the
ones
past.
Do we call Star Wars? We call New Hope Star Wars.
Yes.
We call 1 through 3 Star Wars.
Yeah, when they're out, when they're in theaters.
When they're in theaters.
You refer to it as
but
Star Wars.
Empire Strikes Back, I called Empire Strikes Back, and Return of the Jedi, I called Return of the Jedi.
Well, that's what I'm saying. I think I called them Star Wars then, too.
I call them because if you recall the font, it was like really big, the Empire Strikes Back. And then just to remind you, it had like Star up at the top and Wars down below.
I do remember that.
Just like, remember this is part of Star Wars, but everyone I knew called it the Empire Strikes Back. Are you going to see Empire Strikes Back?
Do you remember? This is part of Star Wars.
But those are the only two that we call by their actual subtitles.
Well, we have to agree to disagree. Because
okay.
I think now,
I'm
going
to disagree to disagree.
To differentiate them now, of course we use those subtitles.
Mm-hmm.
But when they're in theaters, I'm going to say from back in the day to present,
this may be a Philly thing. This may be a generational thing. even though it was occurring at the same time.
I know. Look, I'm 2 years older than you.
Sure.
When I was a kid, we did things a little differently.
Oh, yeah. When I was a kid, at the exact same time.
Yeah,
slightly
so easy.
Younger.
Yeah, it's so easy.
I believe I called it Empire Strikes Back and Return of the Jedi. But now you're right. We should call this one a Star Wars story.
Yeah.
We should call it a Star Wars story.
Yeah.
Instead of, what is it called? Rogue One. I think everyone's going to call this one Rogue One, don't you think?
I think they
are. This is the first one in 25, 30 years that we're going to actually call by its actual name.
And it's outside of the typical continuity that we're familiar with. Mm-hmm. I think it's a prequel of sorts.
It's inside the continuity.
There's other continuity. But...
but it's outside the sphere of characters that we are normally accustomed to.
It's outside of what is considered normal, right, or just.
Right. Is it actually out yet, by the way? I'm going to check here. We got, it's out. So it's, from what I understand, it tanked at the box office this weekend.
Oh,
because of the protests, of course. You've heard about the protests.
The Star Wars story protests?
There were Star Wars protests, which killed the film. The Trump people were protesting Star Wars.
Why were they doing that?
I don't even want to get into it. But they Hamilton and Star Wars, the two things they protested.
Hamilton's done.
Closed. They shuttered it.
Wrapped it all up. Too bad.
Oh, well. Tell you what, why don't we get into the countdown? Why don't we get into the countdown? Our first clip of the countdown is episode 15.
Number 15.
All right, episode 15.
All right.
Now, Paul, you don't know what these episodes are.
No.
These are all a surprise to you.
They're all a surprise to me.
And you are a part of some of them. I can tell you that.
Yeah, and I'm a quarter goldfish, so I don't remember a lot of things. Mm-hmm. And I'm constantly.
You're a quarter goldfish in the brain and the penis.
Yep.
That's the quarter.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't have a penis, you just lay eggs.
Yeah, love it.
You love
I'm doing it right now.
Stop laying eggs, by the way.
Will you fertilize these, please?
All right, let me come on. There you go.
Please, a little decorum.
Now, you don't know what these episodes are. You don't know what order the results are in. And so that's why I'm going to tell you some information about them right before we listen to them.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So now what we do is we vote from Thanksgiving of the previous year to Thanksgiving. And that gives us time to compile the clips.
Makes sense.
Normally, we've talked about this on the show before. Normally, the older the episode, the more people have forgotten about it.
Exactly.
And the newer the episode, the more recent they are, and they usually vote for those over the older episodes.
It just makes sense. It's human nature.
Mm-hmm. Would it surprise you then, sir, to know that our 15th most popular episode of the year was from January 4th?
What?
That's right. The first episode of this calendar year, not the first episode in contention, but January 4th.
Mm.
That's right.
But what about the theory we just talked about?
I know. It's been blown out of the water by this one example, but perhaps more later on.
I don't know.
Paul, snap out of it.
Ah, thank you. Thank you.
I'm going to be slapping Paul several times throughout this show.
Yeah, that's another tradition we have.
Yep. Slap fight. One-sided slap fight.
Slap fight.
Okay, that means I get to slap you anytime you call it out.
Yeah.
One of these days, slap back.
We'll see.
Slap back.
Let's slap back.
I have a great credit card. It gets lots of slap back.
I don't know what that means. Like cash
neither
back?
Do I. Maybe. All right, here we go. This is episode.
Lauren couldn't be here.
This is episode 393. It's from January 4th. First episode of the calendar year. Paul, do you know what the tradition is for Comedy Bang Bang? First episode of the calendar year.
You, Ben Schwartz, and Horatio Sanz.
That's right. Ben Schwartz, Horatio Sanz. We always get together. Maybe we will this next year in 2017. Who knows? Traditions are made to be broken, but...
That's not true.
Oh, really? They were made
They're
to
They're made to like, continue stay the on? Same, yeah.
Well, wait a minute.
That's the whole point.
I got... there's that tradition of marriage that I got into. I thought that was made to be broken as well.
No.
Oh, Kulap and I are getting divorced.
Why?
Yeah.
Scott!
Because it's a tradition.
This is how I find out?
Yes! How did you want to find out? Hold on.
Divorce is also a tradition.
That's true.
It's an institution.
That's right. About 50% of the time. Even more.
I don't know if that's true anymore.
Oh, really? Has it lowered?
I think it's lowered.
Because less people are actually getting married, probably.
I think more people are just dying. They're dying in their teens.
Oh, boy. Okay. This is an episode called Peanuts Awareness. Or Peanut Awareness. I can't remember.
I think it was Peanut Awareness.
Peanut Awareness. Great episode. I remember a lot of laughs on this one, and this people are going to hear it. Now, this is Ben Schwartz, of course. You know him as BB-8, the voice of BB-8 in Star Wars. Oh, proving your point. And he is himself, and Horatio Sanz, he comes in with, sometimes he's himself and then he goes into a character.
That's right.
Sometimes he's himself and has the barest grasp upon a character. This is a character named Ted Ronson. He's portraying a character named Ted Ronson. And he has, there's a month that he wants to call attention to for some special awareness. Very fun episode. This is our clip for your episode number 15. Here we go.
Number 15.
Peanut awareness.
Peanut awareness time.
Peanut.
Peanut.
Peanut. You put the peanut in the drink.
You put the peanut, poison peanut.
What if in the trial, we're talking about a lot of hot button issues on this episode
all
today.
All fun stuff.
Fuck it. Let's talk about what if in the trial it came out that it was like, it turns out Mr. Cosby has not been slipping drugs into drinks. He just puts one peanut into everyone's drink.
How? What if that comes out in the trial?
What if that comes out and everyone's like, has to apologize to him?
But what now? Oh, so it comes out that this is actually what was happening.
Yeah.
Not that this is what his defense is claiming.
Yeah. But no, this is what actually happened. They prove it conclusively.
So all these women are like, oh, I guess now that I think about it,
there was a weird peanut in my drink. Yeah. And I had consensual sex with him. I apologize, Mr. Cosby.
But now... Okay, so if the peanut is not drugged in any way.
It's not drugged.
It's just a peanut.
He's just got a weird thing about putting a peanut.
Puts a peanut in there because it makes it feel powerful.
Puts a peanut in the drink.
I put a peanut in your drink.
So then, I'm not saying it's likely. So, I'm saying what if it happens?
It's highly unlikely.
But there's a chance.
But before I can address the what if of it,
yeah.
I want to make sure I understand.
Sure.
That these women, they're having consensual sex with
consensual
him,
sex.
That later in their minds, they reframe as him having drugged them.
Well, they got caught up in the wanting to be famous, and they accuse him.
Sure. Oh, okay. So they know they're lying. It's not that.
Some of them know they're lying, and some of them just in there. We're all the heroes of our own stories.
Some of them did have a peanut slipped into their drink.
They all had peanuts slipped into their drink.
But I mean, some of them have a peanut slipped into the drink, and that caused them to have consensual sex with Dr. William H. Cosby.
No, it never caused them. They chose to.
No. Okay.
Or they were so impressed by it that they chose to.
I just meant something about the peanut being put into the drink.
Don't blame the peanut.
Made these...
Don't blame the peanut. I'm saying that
that old expression.
Two separate things.
You're going to hide behind that? Don't blame the peanut?
He put a peanut in the drink. That's totally separate from them having consensual sex.
Consensual.
I may have said consensual.
So what happens is at the trial.
Yes. At the trial, every single person.
The defense says, Your Honor, all my client did.
The defense doesn't know about this. This is something they stumble into.
What?
They stumble into it because so many people are up there on the stand. They go, well, I found a peanut in my drink. And then the defense attorney goes, so many peanuts. And then whispers in Bill Cosby's ear and he goes, oh, yeah, of course I put the peanut in the drink.
I like to put the peanut in the drink.
And they go, stop everything or let the trial continue and let me speak. That's probably more specific. Okay. Yeah. If they stopped everything, it would just be like, well, you're free to go, Mr.
Objection.
Cosby.
Okay. So.
And then they call everyone back up to the stand in tandem. All of the victims, supposed victims.
In tandem.
They say, everyone, come back up together.
Oh, okay.
Come back up together. Yeah, right. Big group style. Family style. Olive Garden style.
Yeah.
Come back up here.
So tallest in back, shortest in front.
Sure. And they say, did you all find peanuts in your drinks?
And answer all at the same time.
Three, two, one.
Yes, Your Honor. So it comes out when they're on the stand individually.
Yes. They all mention having seen a peanut in their drink, offhandedly.
Offhandedly.
The defense lawyer puts two and two together, calls everyone back up, and then calls Mr. Cosby to the stand and says, isn't it true that you didn't put any drugs in the drinks, you just put a peanut in the drink? And Mr. Cosby says, Dr. Cosby, so sorry, Scott. Says, I put the peanut in the drink.
I put the peanut in the drink.
Which then causes the judge to go, you're free to go, Mr. Cosby. And then he goes, sorry, Dr. Cosby.
Right. Okay.
Not likely. I'm not saying it's likely.
So you're saying, what if that happened?
What if that happened?
That would be weird.
It would be weird, wouldn't it? All right, we need to take a break. When we come back, we'll have your episode 14 right after this. Comedy Bang Bang, we're back here. Paul F. Tompkins coughing up a storm.
I'm dead.
I put the pee. The countdown's really moving. We've heard one episode.
It's really moving.
Haven't we?
It's really moving, haven't we?
It's really moving, haven't we? Now, why don't we get to it? Let's get to your episode 14.
Yeah.
All right, episode 14 now.
Number 14 with a bullet.
The previous episode was from very early in the year.
You said January, as I recall.
January, yes, January 4th. Mm. This episode is from November 7th.
What?
Just a mere month ago, right before the cutoff date.
But under the wire?
Just right under the wire. As a matter of fact, if I may check my notes, this is the latest. Oh, I don't even. Well, I'll just say it. This is the latest episode. I know that's going to give some people. They're going to realize the next two in the that were in the eligibility period are not in the countdown. But this is the latest episode.
Scott, shut up for a second. I don't know that you've always employed this system of tons and tons of printed out emails. Has this always been what you've
done?
Someone
just printed it out. Normally, it's on my phone.
Okay.
Yeah. Normally, I look at it on my phone, but it's a little bigger here in the emails. So.
And you know what? Our eyes are not what they used to be, are they, old chum?
No, sir, but you're going to hear lots of this over the next four episodes.
This is the proof.
Lots of paper rustling. No, this is the latest episode that was voted for.
Insane.
And this is an episode, this is number 456. This is an episode called The Historic Rap. Yes, that's right. Mm-hmm. This is Jason Mantzoukas and Paul F. Tompkins himself. That's right.
That's me.
First episode on the countdown, old boy.
I can't. I'm a little mad that it took two episodes in.
Okay.
I'm a little. I'll just say this right now to the listener.
You wanted to be in the very first one.
It's a mystery to me why I'm not in all of them, and I have no choice but to take it as a personal affront.
Well, you're not on the show every single week. That would be weird if you weren't in them.
We'll get into that later.
Mm-hmm.
But that's a separate
beef. Hey, good looking. I'll be back to pick you up later. And we'll talk about that.
Jingle bells.
A little later.
Jingle bells. Yeah, it's a tradition.
It's a tradition. Well, let's save it, though.
Yeah, well, let's save it and savor it.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So you're upset, though.
I'm furious that anyone votes for any episodes that I'm not on and that I'm not on the show every week.
Okay. You'd like to be on the show every week, really?
Oh, this sounds like a be careful what you wish for situation. Exactly.
It's a real monkey's paw.
You're a real monkey's paw. How dare you?
Hey, how dare you?
You're a real Zoltar machine.
I'm turning everyone into... I got confused. I thought I was turning people into little boys. But Zoltar would turn people into big boys.
He does turn back at the end.
He's essentially, Zoltar is stealing life from people. He's taking 20 years of life out of people. What does he do with those 20 years?
I don't know that we talked about this.
We have not.
On mic or if this was off stage.
Was it? Okay.
Maybe we had this conversation during the tour.
Okay.
I would love to see a sequel to Big that is just Elizabeth Perkins' character.
We may have talked about this.
And how she deals with that moment where she sees the little boy
right.
that she had sex with
yeah.
as a man.
And I think waits around another 20 years hoping that he comes back to her.
You don't think she's haunted by this weird situation?
Of like, I just had sex with an adult penis that is in reality a child penis?
A child's brain was in this man's body. He right. tricked me into having sex with him. And now I see yeah. he's just a little boy. And now I have to live with that.
I have to live with that.
Yeah.
And it's the best sex I've ever had. And that's...
I was in love with this child, man.
Yeah. and now I'm attracted to children.
Yeah. Well, I didn't want to...
Maybe. I'm presuming.
I didn't mean to suggest that.
That's what I'm presuming.
But she would be suspicious of every man.
Every single man.
From that point on.
Can I ask you a question? What did you do from age 10 to 30?
Yeah. Where'd you go to college? Talk to me about your other girlfriends.
You've had sex before, right?
How old were you when you started?
You're not a 10-year-old virgin.
How old were you when you started shaving? When did you get your driver's license?
Good stuff. All right, speaking of good stuff, let's hear a little bit of, this is your episode 14, the historic rap, Paul, you play Cal Solomon.
Cal Solomon, founding member of the Sugar Hill.
Now, talk about the origins of this character. Did this start on Spontanea Nation, your own podcast?
It did. It started as, in the early days of the podcast, I would, because I wanted the ads to be entertaining, as well as the rest of the show, I would often make up characters just for the ads, and they would sort of have little stories that would continue. And some of those were Al A. Peterson,
Smooth Criminal. We heard him last week.
It started as an ad person, and Cal Solomon was one. And his story got pretty detailed over the course of these ads. And so when we were doing the tour and we were doing so many shows.
You had to think up characters to do and film.
Yeah,
we did 40, I believe we did 40 live shows this year. You maybe did 38 of those. Or maybe 39.
I think I only missed San Diego and
I think you only missed San Diego because you did South by Southwest as well.
Yeah.
That's one that that may be the only one that you missed.
I think so.
Is
so
that true?
Over the course of that many shows, in order to keep it fresh and not just for the audience, in order to get our fresh certification, which we had to do before every show. We had to go to the local podcast certification board and get the show certified fresh. It just seemed like rather than trying to invent countless stories for these same characters.
The same people that we've done.
Which, frankly, we've already been doing.
Several tours, yes.
Yes.
New stories for new characters.
New stories for new characters.
Newsies.
And so I went looked up on the Spontanea Nation wiki that a young lady named I don't know if this is her actual name. Her screen name is Marius Perkins, and she has kept a list.
Is she a character?
She might be.
Who does her?
I think that's a Mary Holland. She kept a list of the advertising characters.
Oh, wow.
And their stories. So. It was a huge help.
Wow. Okay. So you would look these up as we were on tour and go, this was Cal Solomon. So this is one of those. He made it to the tour. As I recall, New York was the first time that he was on and now has made it to the show proper. Right in Under the Wire from November. First, we're going to hear me talking to Jason Mantzoukas for a bit. And then Cal Solomon comes in and we'll hear a little bit about what he's up to. This is Episode 14.
Number 14.
Oh, so good. So right.
As we found out, and it comes up in this episode,
Cal
Solomon is maybe the only character who's not antagonistic towards you.
Yeah, the one. And on the tour, that got to be a big grueling, having a fake argument every night. I really loved when Cal Solomon would be on, as I would finally have a little respect.
Cal was, he was very happy to be there. Cal is a guy who is very self-aware. He's got his dreams, but he's, he is very aware of his limitations.
Sure.
He hopes to get past them.
Sure.
But the outlook is not so good.
Doesn't watch anything with rap in it. Only The Wedding Singer.
Here's a little behind the scenes.
Yeah. Because we just heard that clip.
That was a completely happy accident.
Happy Gilmore.
That I knew there was.
Happy Madison, I should say.
They'll see.
Well, they should call happy accidents happy Madisons.
You want to get mad that the characters have an antagonistic relationship with you, but then you do things like that.
Hey.
But when the idea of – when Cal was challenged on, being aware of rap and seeing –
Because you threw it out there at one point that you had never, anytime you hear rap, you turned it off or something like that, right? Or you just had never seen anything with a rap in it?
I think just I had never seen anything with a rap in it.
Right.
And
we started listing... We started listing things that had rap in them. Is that what it was? We I just heard it.
Yeah. I but I pulled The Wedding Singer because I remembered from the trailer that there was a Rappin' Granny in it.
Yeah, you only liked Rappin' Granny. Yeah.
Yeah. What I did not know
was that or she remember, raps
was that she rapped
The Rapper's Delight,
which is, we can surmise, this is the only rap song Cal has ever heard.
Yes, you're working on levels that just are subconscious at this moment. Yeah, so you don't even know.
Exactly. So I'm a genius is my point.
Speaking of geniuses, let's listen to some geniuses do some ads here. We need to take a break. When I say geniuses, I mean myself.
That's right.
Let's take a break. When we come back, we'll have the next episode on your countdown.
The Canada.
Comedy Bang Bang, we are back here. Paul F. Tompkins clearing his throat you after every break.
You won't give me a chance to do it before we come back. Just let me know.
I say, just, all right, here we go. Is that not clear enough?
Well, I don't know that you're talking to me.
All right, you know, okay.
Well, you and Cody might have some sort of deal.
All right, let's get to it. Here we go. This is episode 13.
Ooh, scary.
Boo, if this were a hotel, I wouldn't stay on this floor.
Hell no. I wouldn't sit in the seat on an airline flight.
Number 1, 3.
This is an episode. This is another recent one. And this is more of our theory about they vote for the recent episodes.
This is blowing your theory out of the water. Mm-hmm.
But this is, well, no, this is, oh, no. Proving, this is proving the original theory. Yeah. This is from October 24th.
That's 2 months ago.
Of this year, just 2 weeks previous to our previous episode on the countdown.
This is weird.
This is an episode called Pow Pow Power Wheels. Yes, this is Weird Al Yankovic, my co-host and bandleader on the Comedy Bang Bang TV show.
Rest in peace.
Rest in peace. Not to Weird Al. He's still alive and kicking, as the Simple Minds once said.
Well, let me get a rest in peace in advance for him then.
Okay, yeah, that's the thing. Why can't we get our rest in pieces before we are already traveling to wherever we're going to travel to?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know, we should walk around saying that to people instead of hello and goodbye.
What if I never see you again?
Rest in peace.
Rest in peace. What is this when people are saying now, I've noticed in the last year, rest in power?
What?
Yeah.
Rest in power?
Yes, yes, yes.
What does that mean?
I don't know, but it sounds like
that sounds
work.
Terrible.
It sounds like the opposite of rest in peace.
Ugh.
Rest in power.
Rest in power. That's,
I don't know,
terrible.
Guys, rest in peace is fine. You don't need to, you know, like tinker with it. It's great.
Rest in power.
Doesn't need any punch up from you.
And by the way, just to fit RIP?
You know? I guess.
That's really strange. Like you're going to what? Like go fight God?
Well, but also you're resting.
Yeah, that's the other
thing.
You don't
want to
be powerful. Yeah, it's just like, go to sleep.
Why do you go to sleep.
That's like one of those people who's like, yeah, I'm such a muscle man that I want to flex while I'm actually sleeping. One of those people. You know those people.
One of them. Yes, of course I do.
So, Weird Al Yankovic, rest in peace. And Claudio Doherty, rest in peace.
Rest in peace.
And, of course, Jessica McKenna, rest in peace.
Was this her debut?
No, this is not her debut, but this is probably her third episode and the second time for this character that she plays.
Oh, this was the second time.
Second time, and this was, I think, the episode that cemented kind of her in the mind. She is a great improviser and someone that she was on the Comedy Bang Bang TV show a couple of times with whom I'd worked. And I've been hearing about her improv a lot. And so we had her on the show. And the first episode that she was on the show, just blown away by...
Blown away.
So amazing at like callbacks, I have to say.
Yeah, really
listens to every single thing. Even before she comes on,
yes,
she will call back like... 12 things that other people have already said.
Yeah.
And hand in hand with that, I don't know whether it's the same part of the brain, but also turned out to be a really great freestyle rapper.
The rap on this episode is so good. I can't imagine it's in the clip. That's too bad.
No,
it is
in the clip.
It is in the clip.
Yes. She, I don't know why we started freestyling. We'll hear the clip, but we just started it. And
why did it start?
I remember I had heard about her being a really good freestyle rapper. And but that was this was not set up. I just when she started, I went, "Oh yeah, I'd heard that about her." And then just sat there while she did it on and on and on, and it was really, really impressive.
Yeah, and people have to understand from a an improv perspective. Somebody who can go like pretty much the length of an actual song,
it's doing crazy. Rap,
it's insane.
Anyone? No, I won't even say that. I don't even think anyone can do one rhyme.
Oh, well, some people can.
No, no, but I was about to say anyone can do one rhyme, but I don't
know.
No,
some people
so.
Can't do.
The people on the street. you know, if you were to get a poll, go, hey, do a freestyle rap. I would say people on the street. 6 out of 10 would not even be able to do one rhyme.
I top out at one rhyme.
Yeah, that's about where I'm
and
at.
And then I'm so relieved that I made it rhyme.
Right.
It goes out of my head. Yeah.
So for a person to go almost as long as an actual song, it's insane to me.
Yeah.
A lot of people have been clamoring for her and Neil Campbell.
Right.
And possibly Amy Poehler, if we can ever get her back.
Epic rap battle.
What a rap battle that would be. Mm. But let's listen to this episode. Claudia.
Rap in peace.
Rap in peace. Rap in power. We have Claudia O'Doherty as herself. Of course, she's playing sort of a version of herself, as she always does.
The only difference, I think, is that her mother doesn't like her very much and keeps inventing.
I don't even know if that's a difference. I can't tell.
Well, that's true. That's true. But the conceit is that her mother keeps inventing these fake contests to get her
to
away.
To get her away out of Australia.
Yeah, to send her away.
So she's playing herself. Weird Al, of course, is himself. And Jessica is playing... a character, a little girl who comes into the studio and she's driving a Power Wheels, which is a little tiny car, and her mom works upstairs and she is unsupervised a lot.
That's right.
So let's hear it. This is your episode 13.
Number 1, 3.
You got it?
I got it.
Paul How just cleared his throat.
How dare you?
I let him clear his throat.
And then Sky went, you got it.
Funny shit.
My personal relationship with this episode
yes.
is I was listening to it as I was driving to the set of Bajillion Dollar Properties in Malibu. Mm-hmm.
The Boo.
And the Boo. Mm-hmm. And Channel 101 fans represent. And it was a day that the production did not seem to be aware, nor was I, that President Obama was visiting Los Angeles.
Oh.
And so it was like Sunset Boulevard was completely closed off from end to end. It's a pretty long street.
That's yeah, from end to end. Boy.
And so I am driving around trying to find a way in to where I have to go.
Right.
And I'm getting very frustrated listening to this episode, which was the only thing keeping me from going on a murderous rampage.
That we hear that a lot, that you know, it's the only thing that keeps people sane during their rides to work and sometimes during work.
It's really true, though. I was in such a frustrating situation because I couldn't. I'm trying to communicate with the production staff, and I ended up being an hour late, which was mortifying.
One calendar hour.
One of your Earth hours. And
wait a minute. Hold on. Huh? Hold on a second.
An hour.
What did you just say?
An hour, like we both say.
Can I ask you a question?
Can I see you in the kitchen?
Can I see you in the kitchen for a second? First off, are you a 10-year-old boy?
Well, what are you talking about?
When was the first time you started shaving?
I shaved this morning.
Okay, great. Okay, good. Covered. Second question, are you an alien?
Yes.
Oh. Whoa.
Yo, I mean.
You have to tell me
undocumented.
Legally.
Undocumented.
Okay, got it.
Build that wall.
Build that lock her up. All right, so.
So anyway.
Yes.
Very frustrating situation.
Made a little bit better.
It made it a lot better. It made it so much. It kept me from just melting down.
And did that hour being late, did that affect the production at all?
It sure didn't, Scott.
No one
I don't
cared.
Think I had to tell anyone. I could have shown up.
Whatever you wanted.
Zero problem.
All right, let's go to a break. When we come back, we are going to hear our first live episode on our
Fuck.
Countdown. That's right. We'll be right back with more Comedy Bang Bang. Comedy Bang Bang. God damn it. That's on purpose.
That was on purpose, guys.
Paul F. Tompkins here, and I'm Scott Aukerman, and we're counting down our top 15 episodes of the year. This is the first episode in the best ofs. We always, or we have been, at least for the past few years, four episodes in a row, and we tape them all in one sitting, and it's crazier and crazier as we go.
Yeah, come on, guys.
It's not weird.
It's not weird. This is what we do.
This is what we do.
There's a precedent has been established.
By the way, when I saw Duran Duran live,
Duran Duran.
That's what John Taylor said. Was they played Girls on Film or whatever their last song was. Later. Everyone started clapping. Whoa! And he said, "This is what we do." Not sure about that.
What?
Like, yes, of course you're applauding. This is what we do.
It sounds like is he. Annoyed by it?
No.
Like, you surprised that this was good?
No.
This is what we do.
No, it was bragging. It was like, of course you're clapping.
We
get it.
We make you go crazy. Uh-huh, uh-huh. You go mad, don't you?
That's a spot on John Taylor from Duran Duran impression.
This is what we do. We make you go mad.
Hey, speaking of other countries, you were doing an accent from another country.
Let's think of one.
Why don't we get to our live episode countdown, the mini countdown within the countdown. This is episode number four.
Number four.
All right. This is the fourth most popular. We did 40 live shows this year. I believe 39 of them are eligible for this because... Because one of them was in the regular feed, the South by Southwest episode. So the other 39 were eligible for voting, and everyone got to pick their top five, and we're going to count down our top four, and this is number four.
And for this, people had to go, behind the paywall.
Oh, so scary. So, so scary.
Oh, wait, was that you screaming or was that a scream that's happening somewhere behind the paywall?
That was behind the paywall.
It sounded like a sound effect. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. That is, by the way, number nine on our sound effects record.
Oh, finally. We're getting closer and closer. How many tracks altogether?
I believe we said we were going to be doing tracks. 99. The most you can on a CD.
That's right.
All right, this is episode, this is your your fourth most popular live episode, and this is from August 1st. Can you put your mind where you were August 1st?
August 1st.
We recorded this on August 1st,
8-1. We were in, I'm going to say we were in Australia.
No.
Oh, we were in Montreal?
Montreal. Pepe.
Pepe Le Frog.
Pepe Le Frog.
The Isle.
Repeat, the Isle. Montreal. This is Montreal. Now, this is an episode. It was you, Lauren Lapkus, Nick Kroll, and John Mulaney.
Mm-hmm.
A great group.
Gigi. This one I remember. This was the first of the shows where it was very difficult to hear anyone else on stage.
That's right. We had a couple of these over the entire tour where it was very difficult to hear. And this one, it is a testament to how funny everyone is that we cannot hear each other at all.
Yeah.
Unless
someone's face was pointed directly at you.
Which is not the case when you're performing. You don't want to see a bunch of people in profile looking directly at each other.
No, because we're all vain.
Vainglorious.
Vainglorious Pop and Jays.
But it is a testament to how funny this episode is and how much people liked it that even though we couldn't hear each other, the recording of it is very funny and everyone is very funny. Now, you are playing Big Chunky Bubbles.
That's right.
Which Big Chunky Bubbles was born on tour.
Born on tour.
Born
minutes before a show.
That's right. We were at a restaurant and something on a menu at the restaurant we were at right before the show.
It was in the description of an item, some kind of stew or something.
Big Chunky Bubbles.
Big Chunky Bubbles.
And you said, oh, I should be a character called Big Chunky Bubbles. We said, great. And then minutes later, you were.
That's pretty much it.
And it has become a staple of the show. Big Chunky Bubbles maybe dislikes me more than any of the other.
He's a very unpleasant guy.
He doesn't like anybody. I shouldn't take it personally. The other ones I do.
Don't take it personally. I understand. But he's an unpleasant guy.
This is Big Chunky Bubbles. And Lauren is playing Pamela from Big Bear, who is an insane person.
A lethal combination.
Two terrible people. And then we have, of course, Nick Kroll and John Mulaney, and they're playing their characters, Gil and George, from the Oh Hello Show, and which is currently on Broadway, and taking the Great White Way by storm.
It sure is.
And people love them, and this has a lot of riffing with them together. And just imagine us straining to understand what they're saying.
Here's what was great, though. When John and Nick came out, it took the pressure off needing to hear because they just talked and talked. And I was like, oh, okay. Oh, well, I honestly, and I don't mean that as a slam.
No, it's not a slam. It was literally a relief.
Oh, this is great. Okay, they'll just go.
Because the three of us, Lauren, you and me, had been having such trouble trying to figure out what we were saying. I believe you may have came out first, and you and I could at least talk to each other because we started.
You can't have Pamela from Big Bear come out first ever.
Yeah.
She's an insane person.
But you and I talked for a good 20, 25 minutes, I believe, and we were trying to face each other as much as we could, and so we did an okay job, and then Pamela came out, and we couldn't hear what she was saying at all. And we were like, oh, fuck, what is going to happen? By the way, this would all be easily solved by monitors that were turned up and pointed at us, but apparently the Montreal Comedy Festival, just for laughs, not just for monitors.
Got to put that in the rider, bruh.
It is in the rider.
It's in the rider, bruh.
They don't call it just for monitors. They call it just for laughs.
Wait, they do or don't call it just for monitors?
They do not. They actually don't. Do not.
Okay.
It's JFL, not JFM. So when Nick and John came out, it was such a relief to us of like, oh, these guys know their characters so well and they're so in the pocket.
And they'll never stop talking.
And they don't stop talking and they're really funny while they do it. We could just sigh and go, guys, have at it.
It was like a working vacation.
It really was. So let's hear it. This is your number four.
Number four.
Great stuff.
Rest in
power. What an episode. Well, tell you what, let's take a break.
Okay.
When we come back, we'll have our final episode that we're going to count down of this, our first installment of The Best Ofs. We'll be right back with more Comedy Bang Bang after this. Comedy Bang Bang. We're
Comedy
here with
Bang Bang.
Comedy Bang Bang.
We're here with me.
With Paul F. Tompkins.
And with you.
Scott Aukerman.
That's your name.
That is me. And here, let's get to it. Let's get to your episode number 12.
Let's do it, man.
Number one, two.
All right. Well, zigzagging, which is a cross between zigzagging and examining. What am I trying to say?
What?
I said zigzagging.
Was that cartoon about the little alien?
Zigzam? I don't know. What little alien are you talking about?
Invader Zim.
Oh, Invader Zim, yes.
Yeah.
Which Daniel Koenig wrote for. And just, by the way, wrote an issue of the Invader Zim comic book in stores now.
Well, there you go.
That's right.
Little plug for the hilarious Daniel Koenig.
This is an episode zigzagging from later in the year. This is now back towards the beginning of the year. This is February 8th, and this is episode 400.
Right? Oh, that's like a milestone episode.
That's a milestone episode.
No, that's a milestone episode.
And on the hundreds, we've been having two people. That's right. Jason Mantzoukas, the aforementioned Jason Mantzoukas, and Andy Daly. And we've been getting together. I think we did episode 200, episode 300, and episode 400 together.
Sounds about right.
100 was Rob Hubel and Tom Lennon coming back.
The original from the first episode.
From the very first episode. That's right. And so, but then on 200, 300, 400, it's been Jason, J-Dog, Mantzoukas, and Andy Daly, and this is an episode called The War on Surfing. Did I say that?
You did not until now.
The War on Surfing. And this is Andy Daly doing his character Hot Dog. Hot Dog is an older gentleman who he likes to water ski.
Mm-hmm.
And he water skis on sausages, very long sausages instead of skis.
That's right.
And we find out that in this episode, he hates surfers and there is some sort of war going on.
Yeah. Hot Dog also, worth mentioning.
Yeah. Oh, very worth mentioning because it'll come
up. Huge fan of the musical group Sha Na Na.
Sha Na Na.
And has been auditioning to be a member of Sha Na Na for most of his life.
He's one of those people who can't just be a fan of something. He wants to be a part of it.
Exactly. Don't get me started on fan theories and how much I despise them.
But do you think there are fan theories about about this show?
I do. I think there's fan theories about everything.
Yeah, there probably are. About like what Hot Dog's up to or what's going to be next with
the Bible.
Mm-hmm, the Bible. What a fan I am of the Bible as well.
Big fan.
Big fan.
2 Corinthians.
You know those comic conventions for the Bible they have every Sunday?
Yep.
Sometimes people come in costume.
That's right. That's how popular the Bible is. There's cons every week.
Yeah, not just during the summer. Not once a year.
All over the country.
It's incredible. All right. This is Hot Dog is going to reveal some very interesting things. and let's hear it. This is The War on Surfing. This is your episode 12.
Number 1, 2.
Oh, what a revelation.
What a revelation.
He's not a Highlander. He's trained by the real convicted murderer, Edward Solly.
Now, Jason and Andy, I think, have known each other for a long time from back in New York, right?
Yeah, I would say so. They both UCB New York people.
And Jason is a mischievous character.
He's a devil. He's a little devil.
He's a little devil. He's a little stinker.
Mm-hmm.
But I think he takes a particular delight in trying to paint Andy Daly
path.
Into a corner. Yeah.
Yes, that's true. Yeah. Because Andy is one of those people who can get out of those corners expertly.
Yes.
Have you ever like trap an animal in a corner? And
I love it.
It's so fun because they can usually get out. But you know those times where the animal is trapped and knows it's going to die? That's not as fun.
No, it's not fun because you see the look on their face where they just say, I have to accept my fate. Yeah.
Mama, I'm coming home.
I'm no longer in control of my stupid instincts.
Mm-hmm.
I submit.
Yeah.
Do what thou wilt, sir.
You know how, and then, of course, you kill the animal.
I crush its skull.
Yes, of course. These are flies we're talking about, by the way.
Flies and raccoons, but I'll do it with a handle of a tennis racket.
Sure, yeah. Either one, flies and raccoons.
Yep.
Good for both.
All the same to me.
That's the Spalding promise. Good for both. Great episodes.
Great episode.
And we have to wrap it up here for this particular episode of The Best Ofs.
It's sad.
It is sad.
Every ending is sad.
What's not sad is the fact that we have another episode coming out this Thursday. So just wait a few mere days and we will be back to count down episode 11, 10, 9, and 8 in the countdown. And that's even more exciting because they get better and better.
I guess they do, right?
Mm-hmm. They do.
Yeah. Yeah, that makes sense.
It does.
I think I get this now. I don't think I got it until...
Until just right now? This is the eighth year that you've been doing this.
Nobody's more embarrassed than I am.
I'm embarrassed for you, so...
I thought, why are we listening to these out of order?
They're in a very specific numerical order.
Scott, I get that now.
Okay.
Jesus. I admit it, I'm wrong. What more do you want from me?
I want you to apologize.
I am sorry to you.
Thank you. That's all I wanted.
The listener. You didn't let me finish.
Let me finish.
I'm going to let you finish.
So many let me finish memes in the world. There's the Ross Perot. There's the Kanye.
The Ross Perot. Can I finish?
All right. We're going to wrap it up here. We'll see you on Thursday. And there may be a special surprise on Thursday's episode. Don't want to say what it is, but we
Cupcakes?
Will.
Cupcakes?
Nope. I did bring some brownies. We pigged out on them right before
this.
We did
have a pig out session.
Yep. All right. Let's wrap it up there for now, but we'll see you on Thursday. All right. Thanks. Bye. Better buttered and slightly salted than slightly buttered and salting the wounds from your failed romantic adventures in popcorn saleswomen. Welcome to Comedy Bang Bang. I don't know what that is referring to, but thank you to Pam Greer's legs for that. Hey, paying attention to a different part of her body.
Congratulations.
I guess. Hey, welcome to Comedy Bang
Pam
Bang.
Pam Greer's legs. Two minutes later.
This is what we do.
This is what we do.
Welcome to the show. This is Scott Aukerman, and across from me is good old PFT.
Ah, that's right, everybody.
That's right, Paul F. Tompkins.
It's me, Paul F.T.
Mm-hmm, he's back. This is Best of Comedy Bang Bang 2016 Part 2. And over these episodes, we are counting down your top 15 episodes of the year that you have voted on.
You.
You, the listener, have typed in your choices,
you
and you got to pick 10, and we have compiled all those votes.
You did it.
And we're counting down your top 15, and not just your top 15 normal episodes, but your top 4 live episodes of the year mm-hmm. as well.
That's
so
right.
That's a little wrinkle on the countdown. And this is number 2 of those. On the previous episode, we counted down 15 through 12.
Yes, we did. So, and yes. 4 through 4.
4 through 4 of the lives. What do you think we're counting down this time?
I think it's going to be – well, the first one was 15 through 12?
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to say this is going to be 11 through 10.
No, that would only be 2 episodes.
Right. So no?
Nope. This is
– we're,
I mean, we
more?
Are going to do those, but it's going to be 11 through 8 and 3 through 3.
Okay. Okay.
That's right. We're going to crack the top 10 very, very soon.
See the TT.
Yeah, that's right.
Scott, and, Scott. Let me ask you.
Go ahead. I mean, hey, what do I give a shit if you ask me something? I don't care. Go ahead.
Ooh, you sound like you're protesting a little bit too much.
I mean.
Methinks.
I'm not hiding anything. You go ahead and shoot. I'll take any question.
Okay, now you really sound like you're hiding something.
Hiding what? What could a guy like me possibly be hiding?
I don't know, but
I'm an open book. I've lived a good life.
Are you an alien?
Yes!
We're both aliens?
We're both aliens. Why haven't we talked about this before?
Oh. Are we from the same planet, do you think?
Well, hold on. Let's see. What's your planet like?
Gorplox 5!
Gorplox 4.
Oh, so close.
Yeah, I hate Gorplox 5.
When you ask me what it's like that.
Oh, it's like it.
But I'm from Gorplox 4.
Oh, okay. So am I.
Oh, okay. Great.
Oh, great. We love each other.
But haven't you ever noticed how much it's like Gorplox 5?
It's so much alike, and yet I hate them. Isn't that interesting?
Oh, I want to destroy them. And Earth.
Hey, I'm right there with you, buddy.
How did you feel about the first Best of episode that we just did?
How did I feel about our banter or about the
overall? Just everything.
Overall, I thought A+. Like, we talked about Star Wars. We talked about Bill Cosby and the peanut.
That parable.
Bill Cosby, the parable of
it reminds me of the
snake.
Parable of Bill Cosby and the peanut.
What I would love that if 300, nay, 1,000 years from now, people talked about that parable, much like, you know, Damocles' sword and all that. That's something, right?
Yeah, that's something where Damocles had this sword. He kept it on the ceiling.
Mm-hmm.
And then he was like, mistake.
Mistake. Let me get out from under this thing. Is it the Gordian knot?
The Gordian knot, yes.
Of course.
Yeah. Impossible to untie unless you just cut that shit in half.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That, to me, that is, instead of a big lesson about how to solve problems, that's like the first guy who decided to be smart. No one thought to cut this thing till then. Like,
this guy breaks the rules. Right?
I guess, but that's like, now we're all so smart. If there was a knot you could barely untie, you'd spend like 30 seconds trying to untie it, and then you'd get some scissors, right?
I mean, it depended on what you – if it was like your shoes.
Maybe not scissors, yeah.
Well, maybe right. You would. If you had backup laces, you'd be like, I'm just going to start from scratch.
How many backup laces do you keep at your house, by the way?
I have – it's not a steamer trunk, but it's like a mid-sized suitcase
okay.
filled with shoelaces.
Just filled with laces, and are they packets of laces that are bunched up so where you
loose,
can just loose laces?
Like, they're probably all in knots, frankly, and it's a mess.
Wow.
Yeah. So I got to take all those.
Are you a hoarder?
Well, I mean, I don't think so because I think I need a lot of pill bottles. I need pill bottles, newspapers, cat skeletons.
Oh, God. A lot of animal death.
I need them.
A lot of animal death on these episodes.
A lot of animal death.
How do you feel about the last episode?
Well, but hold on a second, though. There's so many animals. I mean, fucking, come on. So some of them die in the, theoretical conversations.
Sure. We're not actually doing it. Wink, wink.
Yeah, we're not even having the conversations. They're theoretical.
Yeah.
I feel like that last episode, the last Best of episode.
Mm-hmm. You can be honest with me. Go ahead.
I think it was the best thing I've ever done.
What? Mm-hmm. The best thing you've ever done? Better than even these episodes that we're counting down right now?
Oh, way better.
That is high praise. What a career you've had. You started out in Philadelphia as a stand-up comedian.
In Philadelphia, I was born and raised.
Mm-hmm. You then traveled to Los Angeles, where you worked upon shows like Mr. Show and others.
Yeah. That's right. Not necessarily the news. That's right.
That's right. Oh, and Real Time with Bill Maher, where you started the clock. You were the first person to start the clock.
They made me. You know what? That was humiliating. They made me start the clock.
So when he said start the clock, he was actually yelling at you.
Yeah.
That's like having your boss yell at you.
Yeah, and no one even got to see me on camera. Start the clock.
That's you start every single episode until...
When you hear that clock,
yeah.
I started it.
And he's yelling at you
They still make me do it now.
Automate
I'm
that thing.
I'm not even getting paid.
Although, would you rather a robot did it? You know what I mean?
What, like the head of Carl's Jr.?
Yeah, exactly. I didn't know robots made all of those burgers and all of my boners when I watched their commercials.
It makes sense now, though, when you think about it. It does. Like, when you think, like, oh, yeah, I got erect when I was watching that commercial. A robot did that.
Yep. All right, Paul, we're going to count them down. Here we go.
We're going to count them down.
Here we go.
We're going to count them down.
Here we go.
We're going to count them down.
Here we go. By the way,
we're going to count them down.
At the end of the...
You were trying to talk to me, but you also wanted to
I wanted to sing along. Yeah. We're going to count them down. By the way, we're going to count them down. At the end of the...
We're going to count them down.
Episode, we're going to count them down. Have a big surprise.
We're going to count them down.
And we're going to do it.
We're going to count them down.
The end. Why don't we get to it? This is your episode number 11.
Number one.
Okay, this is
episode number 11.
Hey, 19.
The Cuervo Gold.
By the way, someone on Twitter alerted me to something which made me think, you know that song, Hey, 19? Mm-hmm. Do you think, we talk about it every year.
Every year.
Do you think that it actually was the latest song in a song cycle that Steely Dan had been writing about our American presidents because Rutherford B. Hayes was the 19th president and its original title was Hayes 19?
Yeah, I do think that.
Okay, that's all I wanted to find.
Yep.
Hayes 19.
That's exactly what I think.
The 19th president.
Little is known about you.
All right, this is... why were we talking about Hey 19? Because I don't remember.
It's just always on the edge of our brains.
That's true. Yeah. Now, episode 12, which we heard on the last Best Of episode, that was from February 8th, and that was episode 400. Would it surprise you to know...
I feel like this is going to be a word problem.
Yeah. How fast... Does the train go? No, this episode is episode 401 from 1 week later, February 15th.
It's right. So wait a minute.
Back to back.
B to B.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, these are some good episodes.
These are some good episodes right in a row. That's right. This is episode 401. Love is thicker than water.
Mm.
That's right. Right around Valentine's Day.
Valentine's Day.
That's right. Is it Valentine's Day?
It's the time of year for Valentine's.
I had no... I've been calling it Valentine's.
It's Valentine's.
Wait, it's the time of year for Valentine's.
That's right.
So Valentine's are a thing, but they call it Valentine's.
You give each other Valentine's on Valentine's Day.
You may be mistaken on this.
I doubt I am.
This is the Valentine's Day episode. Yeah. Came out on February 15th. And this is, of course, Paul Rust, Gillian Jacobs, and yourself.
I'm on this?
You're on this. This is for the second year in a row, maybe the third even, Gillian Jacobs returns, and we did an episode together. The previous year was Colin Hayes.
That's right.
And this is Gillian Jacobs, and she and Paul Rust are on a show called Love on Netflix, and they were promoting its premiere. And Paul, you were playing Alan Thicke, who was coming into Gillian and trying to romance her.
Romance and de-pants.
De-pants. Oh, man. Have you ever de-pantsed anyone,
by
the way?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, man.
It is something that is good. I mean, I like to do it.
De-pants thyself, woman.
All right. Sometimes I'll be like, let's get de-pantsed.
Two guys who have never had sex and don't know what it is. So, Paul, right off the bat, you're on the countdown here. You're in the first episode.
Right off the bat, man.
Right off the bat. Why don't we hear it?
The Batman.
Oh, the batting gentleman.
He's
the Batman.
So scary.
Oh, he strikes terror into the hearts of criminals.
Oh, I'm cowardly and superstitious.
you're part of that lot that is.
Yeah, so I heard that there was this giant bat that was... he was punishing pickpockets and purse snatchers.
That's right. When you think about it, by the way, speaking of the Batman... Batman is a rich guy.
Yeah.
Who goes out there and, like, knocks heads around of poor people who are just, like, trying to make ends meet.
Yeah.
And sure, they're crimes.
Yeah.
But it's basically, like, a rich guy beating up poor people.
Yeah. That's
great.
Right.
Great stuff.
Yeah. Because not everybody was a crazy costumed villain. Mm-hmm. In the early days of Batman, he was just straight up
beating up poor
muggers
people.
And stuff like that. Yeah. Yeah.
And spending his millions and now billions, if not trill, of dollars just buying cars in order to beat up people.
Do you think Batman is a trillionaire?
He, you know, if Lil Wayne is now, you know.
Why not Bruce Wayne?
Why not? Yes, that's right.
Sorry to blow up your spot, Batman.
By the way, when Bruce Wayne heard Lil Wayne, mm-hmm. did he think that everyone was talking about himself? When they were like, I love Lil Wayne.
And he thought they were being very dismissive of him. Right. Like, not it's not very respectful.
And they were talking about how he was drinking lean.
Mm-hmm.
Did Bruce Wayne think it was himself?
Do you think Bruce Wayne drinks scissor?
I think he might. It's the only way to keep himself up all night.
Right.
Bashing these heads.
Doesn't it make you sleepy, though, scissor?
Scissor it might. I don't know. Or I don't know. I'm not
I think it's a downer.
I'm not a huge fan. I'm a big fan.
You'll do it socially, but yeah. You won't.
All right, look, we got to listen to this episode. This is your episode 11.
Number 1.
Theme song, Alan Thicke's theme song for love. So funny.
So funny.
So funny and perfectly timely for when that episode came out.
That's right.
Don't you agree?
No longer timely.
Nope. Stop listening to it. And us.
Oh, like that poem.
Turn off your podcast machine.
4 weddings and a funeral.
I just saw that.
Turn off your podcasting machine. No longer timely.
Well, you know what it is time for? It's time to hear a message from our sponsors. We need to take a break. When we come back, we're going to crack the top 10. That's exciting, isn't it?
Yeah.
Wait, you don't sound excited.
I don't know. I guess I didn't, you know. I mean,
you didn't think you were going to live this long?
I never expected this to be here. I thought I'd be resting in power.
You thought you were going to die in between 11 and 10?
Yeah, I just assumed.
No. I mean, unless you do during the break. This is exciting. This is a cliffhanger.
Thank you. I might die during the break.
This is a real cliffhanger. Okay, let's see when we come back if Paul F. Tompkins is alive and not resting in power.
I hope it's an ad for caskets.
All right, here we go. We'll be right back with your top 10. All right, welcome back. Is Paul F. Tompkins still alive? Let's find out now.
Still alive.
Ah, he's back with us. Do you long for the escape that death will bring?
Now I'm thinking that these are recorded and then when I am dead.
People are going to be bummed out.
Might hear
instead
this.
Instead of being happy. That happens a lot. With some of these, you know, we have good friends who have passed on and they get, but we occasionally talk about death, but it's a part of life.
Dear, if I could bring a private thing into the public sphere.
We'll see.
I texted you recently because there was some dude, one of these white supremacist dudes on Twitter that said something to me. And
to
so,
me?
To me?
Suck it to me?
He blinded me with white supremacy?
Supremacy! Supremacy! He blinded me with white supremacy? Time to bring it back, Dolby.
And so it'll show you, you know, you click on someone's account, it'll show you who you might follow, know in common or whatever.
Right.
It said, followed by Harris Whittles. And I just screen capped it and sent that to you.
Oh, right.
It said, in retrospect, bad call, Harris.
Yes. Why was he following? That's so weird.
Who fucking knows?
Who knows? Who knows? All right, we are back. We're cracking the top 10.
Yeah.
This is exciting. This is where the countdown really heats up.
This is where the rubber meets the road.
Exactly.
And Ruben is racing.
And you are wearing a rubber, right?
At all times.
Okay, good.
That was such a big joke in stand-up in the 80s.
Was it?
Like late 80s, because it was the safe sex thing. It was response to the AIDS
sex
scare.
Sex is best when it's one-on-one.
Yeah, it's natural. It's fun. Best when it's one-on-one.
Are you my lover? Do you wear a rubber?
Yeah. I'm Lisa Lefty Lopez. I got a condom in my glasses. But so there was so much – so everybody had condom jokes. Everyone standing in front of a goddamn brick wall had hilarious jokes about condoms. Mm-hmm. And I cannot tell you how many hacks I saw say, I'm wearing one right now.
Right.
And it's like God laughs every time. Every time.
It's a weird time to wear one. I get it. I understand it.
I mean, he's just standing up there doing his job. He's wearing a condom.
Well, Paul, maybe you don't get it.
On his flaccid penis.
Maybe you don't understand it. The penis is hard.
I never made that connection.
Yeah.
So what the joke really is, this guy is saying, I have a rock hard erection right now.
And I may come at any moment. At any moment. And you should be thankful I'm not doing it against my genes.
Yeah.
Against my genes. A Bob Seger.
Coming against my genes.
Coming against my genes.
We listened to a lot of Bob Seger on
the road. Yes.
Fucking great road music.
I got to say, Bob Seger's greatest hits. Great road music, great memories. I will probably always think of the tour when I think of Bob Seger now.
Me too.
And I pop it on every once in a while. Lauren, I was surprised. Lauren is a good, I don't know, 10 years younger than us or something. Mm-hmm. And she knew them all.
She's like 21 years old.
She's like Zoltard.
What?
She's like Ben Zoltard machined.
Her favorite movie.
Yeah.
She loves the movie.
She loves
Big,
really? That's probably because she's like 13 years old.
She is. She's a 13 year old.
I feel weird about having sex with her.
Why did we all have sex together? What a weird tour that was.
What a strange tour. Hey, when in Rome.
But you know, I remember now when it started because people were chanting it from the crowd. They're like, have sex with each other.
With each other.
Yeah, I remember it was a disjointed chant.
Have sex with each other. Have sex. Lock her up.
Build the wall.
Yeah. All right, let's get to cracking that old top 10. Here we go. We'll get to the tour and talk a little bit more about the tour in a minute, but let's crack the top 10. This is your episode 10.
Number 10.
And this is an episode, it may surprise you to learn, called...
Well, we'll see.
From May 23rd, and this is an episode called Time Bobby 4.
Now... The title surprises me?
I don't know. I don't know what surprises you about this
You
information.
Said it may Well, you're the one that said I may be surprised.
I'm saying it's possible that something might surprise you.
Oh.
That's so weird.
Oh, I'm not surprised.
Okay, great.
I know that this was the title of this episode.
I don't care if you are or you're not. I'm just saying you might have been.
I care even less than you do. So.
Time Bobby 4.
I can't believe that we did it again.
Can you believe we did? But I have to say...
I don't mean made the list.
We crazy.
I mean that we did another episode.
We crazy for this one, but I thought the fourth one of the better ones that we've done. Time Bobby, let me explain if you are, this is one of your first times listening to Comedy Bang Bang.
Explain it to me like I'm 5 years old.
Okay, do you need some candy before I continue in order to focus?
Well, I'm five, I wouldn't mind some.
All right, here you are.
Thank you. Pleasure doing business with you.
There is wait, now you're just leaving? Because you got your candy?
It worked. My priorities are candy, little else.
There is a person named Bobby Moynihan. He's a current cast member on Saturday Night Live. Mm-hmm. And he has always loved the show, has loved the podcast. I think listened to it before he got on SNL.
Absolutely.
Super fan, knows a lot of the references, and he...
Knows some deep cuts, too.
He came on, I think his second episode or third episode, he came on and said, hey, I want to play an orphan. That was the only idea he had. And he had the name Forville, which was one less than Fivel. And that was all he had. And that's all we had. And that became the classic episode Time Bobby, one of the better episodes I think we've ever done of Comedy Bang Bang. And, you know, we love nothing more than to beat something into submission. But I have to say, we've done Time Bobby 2, 3, and 4, and each of them very funny, and each of them have made the list, the countdown list, every single time. Now, I have to say, Time Bomb before, a little low on the list than the others one other ones were. I think we were top. I think we were one for Time Bomb 1 and one for Time Bomb 2.
I believe so.
Time Bomb 3, not as much so. Maybe the bloom has fallen off the rose. Who knows? But it is cracking the top 10. And I remember when it came out thinking, wow, this one was probably better than 3. I really thought that 4 was really enjoyable.
It's hard for me because they all blur together.
Yeah.
And I can't remember specifically what was in this one.
This is one where we're going to hear it. Forville believes he's dying.
Yes, okay.
I thought this was a great new wrinkle to it. Let's hear it. This is your number 10.
Number 10.
That's right, Dabda.
That's right.
Uh-huh.
Denial, anger, bargaining.
Despair.
Acceptance. Have sex with each other. Build the wall of sex.
All right. Speaking of acceptance, we need to accept that we need to take a break.
All right.
What do you think about that?
I guess I have no choice.
We still have episode 9 and 8 coming up, as well as the live episode number 3 and a little surprise at the end of the episode. So stick around. We are going to be right back with more Comedy Bang Bang after this. Comedy Bang Bang, we're back here with Paul F. Tompkins, and we're deep in the top 10. I mean, we're balls deep in the top 10 at this point.
We're so in there.
We're up in the top 10's guts.
We're all up in them guts.
Oh, my God. I mean, we heard number 10. That means we're in top 10.
Hey, you know, balls deep is a gross phrase, right?
Yeah, sure.
It's not what you would call couth.
Sure. It's fun to say.
Up in them guts.
Yeah. Even grosser.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because you're acknowledging—
On the scale.
You're kind of acknowledging the clinical nature
Of sex. Yeah.
That it's like, it's these body parts that are inserted and everything.
It's weird to think about, first of all, while you're doing it, that it's strange to think about that you're like in guts. Like that people's stomach linings are just, you know, right next to your penis head.
So is that kind of what, you were saying is that we were having sex so
your lower intestine is mere centimeters away from my shaft.
Yeah. Like I might as well be stabbing my penis. Yeah. Stabbing you with my penis.
Yeah.
In your abdomen.
Yeah.
Into your, like, piercing your stomach lining.
Yeah, you may as well, like, if your belly button were a hole, I may as well just be having sex with
your stomach acids might as well be eating away at the head of my penis.
Right. Yes. That's exactly what one is saying. I'm glad we took a little diversion into really breaking it down. I appreciate that, Paul. Always one to want to discuss those things in great detail, Paul F. Tompkins.
You know me. It's all I want to do is talk about sex.
You could barely say
sex things. I couldn't think of a thing. I was like, do I say a super gross thing or do I say a super innocuous thing?
And instead you almost couldn't get the word sex out.
Sex.
All right, here we go. Let's get into it. This is your episode number 9.
Number nine.
What a weird rumor that Paul McCartney was dead. And that no one was, and people believed it.
Yeah.
And they believed it because of a picture he took where he was out of sync with the other Beatles.
Yeah.
Like I've never understood the logic of that. They took that as evidence. He's out of step with the other Beatles.
Yes.
He's got all these things different than the other Beatles.
The license plate on the car in the picture was a clue. And
But here's what I don't understand.
He's got his shoes off. And
if he were dead, he wouldn't have been able to take that picture.
I think they supposed. Right after the picture was taken, he died.
Because he was out of step with everyone and there were so many differences?
Yeah.
It doesn't make any
all
sense
of those
to me.
Things together.
All those things made him have an aneurysm?
They caused his death, yeah. Well, we don't know. We don't know what the cause is.
It's
all
so strange.
We know is they covered it up.
When he actually, remember, you know, when he turned 64?
Yeah.
Every headline was, Paul is 64, or whatever. Do you think when he actually passes away, rest in power, that... the headlines are Paul is dead?
1,000% they are.
They will be, won't they?
Yeah, for sure.
And we hope doesn't happen. I mean, 2016 was bad enough. We certainly hope that 2017 does not mean that we lose a Beatle.
Mm-hmm.
Because we've already lost one. John Lennon's still around.
Now.
As fans of the show know.
That's right. Now, when Paul McCartney turned 64, did he fulfill all of the things that were in the song?
Well, I don't know if the person he was singing to still needed him.
Well, that's true because it's a question.
Yeah.
It's all a question to...
It's all a question.
It's a second person song.
Like, are you going to still love me?
Will you still need me? Will you still feed me?
Feed me, yeah.
But then he's also saying things like...
you'll be older too.
You'll be older too. We'll have three, we'll have grandchildren and their names will be Vera, Chuck, and Dave.
Is that really the lyric? Yes.
Very specific.
Did that come to pass?
I don't know.
I don't
know.
Find out. Yeah, that's true.
I think he's got grandchildren.
Does he have grandchildren?
He's got a daughter.
He does have a daughter.
She's like, you know, she's old enough, you know what I'm saying? Like,
she hasn't been Zoltard, if you know what I mean.
Why do I feel like there's this new dynamic where I start us on it,
right,
and then when you continue it, then I get grossed
out.
Yeah,
I know. But what's weird is you don't like to start on it.
I know.
Usually I'm
the one
who starts
on it. This is what you've done to me.
I'm sorry. You've coming down to my level.
You've coming down to my level.
You've coming down to my level. Technicality, no down boo.
Oh, remember.
By the way, shirts in the store, available for pre-order. Technicality, no down boo over shirts. Yes.
Wow.
Got a couple of new shirts in the store. Also, a Hey Nong Man ain't nothing to fuck with. So, and speaking of Hey Nong Man ain't nothing to fuck with, let's get to our number nine episode. This is from, guess what? We heard February 15th earlier, which was 1 week after February 8th, which was the previous episode. Oh, this is February 18th. This is episode 402.
This is the following week.
Yeah, just the following Thursday.
The following Thursday.
We've heard 400, 401, and 402 on the countdown
all
at this point.
All in a row.
All in a row. This is an episode called Solo Bolo Trollo. Now, the Solo Bolos, if you're listening for the first time, the Ben Schwartz, who we talked about on our last episode with Horatio Sands, he was on the episode... he was on an episode with me. And
he was on an episode.
Normally, if you're listening to Comedy Bang Bang, the format is thus. I'll have a person, a comedian or an actor on as themselves for a good 20, 25, 30 minutes. And then we'll take a break. And then a comedian will come on and be a character. Now,
it's a weirdo.
A weirdo. Now, we were having such a good time with Ben and I, riffing, that he said we should do a whole episode just of this, just of the riffing together, because he was tired of taking the break and having someone come in and then they got to talk. And then they got to
talk.
So he said, let's do an episode just of this. Now, we did one called the Solo Bolo. People loved it. We did another one called the Solo Bolo Doslo. People love that. That was on the countdown of last year. Mm-hmm. This is the Solo Bolo Trollo. We've also done the Solo Bolo
Quattrollo.
We'll see if that ends up on the countdown. Hint, it does not. And
but we will still see.
We will still see if it
does.
Yes. people liked the Trollo. Weirdly, this is now people I think the Quattrollo was maybe better. That had the birth of the phrase "Hey Nong Man ain't nothing to fuck with," as said by Lin-Manuel Miranda, writer of Hamilton. There is our sound effects record going on, and people like that episode a lot. But I think something about the name, the Trollo, they voted for that instead of the Quattrollo. Maybe we split the vote. Who knows?
Oh.
Maybe if we had only done one this year, it would have been higher on the countdown.
Got greedy.
But we got greedy. We did a Quattrollo. So anyway.
Sure, it's a thing that calls out to be an annual event.
Mm-hmm.
Not
a
biannual event.
Are we saying that right? But this is the one that made the countdown. This is the Solo Bolo Trollo. This is what happens on these is, Ben and I, we get together, we riff a lot and we sing a lot. Kind of like, what you're hearing with Paul and I here doing.
Some, I think more singing happens.
More singing happens. We haven't sung a lot on this one yet.
We have not. I wonder if we'll sing at all.
I wonder if we will. Hint, we will. So we are going to hear a chunk from the Solo Bolo Trollo. This is, we have done something on each one called the Olympic Song Challenge, where one of us starts off singing a song, and then the other one has to jump in with a new song that sort of the previous song reminds them of or has something to do with, and we keep it going as long as we can. They've turned into some wonderful, wonderful musical medleys over the years, and this one is no exception. This is the Olympic Song Challenge from your episode 9.
Number 9.
Yes.
Yes.
The Olympic Song Challenge. And Michael Hartigan, by the way.
Does a great job.
Does a great job putting orchestral arrangements behind those, which we will play one of those a little later in our countdown.
Does them in the dark.
He does them in the dark?
Orchestral arrangements.
Yes. He performs and composes them in the dark.
Well, he's blind.
He is blind. He's blind. Yeah. Yeah. Isn't it weird how so many blind people are good at piano?
Yeah.
Isn't that strange?
Do you think the piano makes them blind?
It's not. I mean, it might be more. Look, don't blame the piano. I've always said that.
Hey, how come there's not a scene in Daredevil where he plays the piano?
Yeah, he should be able to.
Of all people.
Out of anyone.
Yeah.
It seems like he should have never gone into law and just gone into being like a Ray Charles famous guy.
Yeah. I mean, he probably would be able to read music. He just like sense.
How far away
the ink is.
This is a good question. Okay, Matt Murdock, he has extra senses where he's sort of like a bat where he can hear and smell, and this causes a radar sense.
Well, now he doesn't have extra senses.
It's just heightened.
His senses are so heightened that they compensate for his lack of the one sense.
But here's the question. That doesn't mean he can play piano all that well. It just means he can sense where the piano is. He still probably is a dumb shit about like, oh, what? This one goes bing, bong, but you know what I mean? Like, you and I could see a piano. That doesn't mean we can sit down and actually play it all that well.
True, but we're not blind.
But you see what I'm saying?
Scott, I'm trying to go along with your premise that blind people are great at the piano. And now I feel like you're fighting me in your own argument.
I know so, I am. I'm trying to figure out
what our relationship is.
What, you and I?
How we feel about blind people at the piano.
Okay.
Look. Are you blind? Am I the piano?
All right, let's take a break. When we come back, we are going to hear your our live episode will be right after the break. We're going to crack the top three right after this.
Yeah.
We will be right back with more Comedy Bang Bang after this. Comedy Bang Bang, we are back, and it is time, Paul, to crack into our live countdown, our mini countdown within the countdown.
It is time for to crack into it.
Yes. You try talking as much as I'm talking. By the way, how much, what do you think the ratio is?
You act like I don't know what this is. Like, I've never done the same thing.
I know.
You try talking for 5 minutes.
But now that I'm on a new topic.
Oh, new topic.
What do you think the ratio is of talking on these best ofs? You to me. 60-40, or is it
oh my God,
a true 50-50?
I think it's probably 55-45.
Yeah. Okay. What about 51-50?
Oh, shit. I can't drive 55. Oh, you ate one too?
All right. Let us get into our mini countdown, our live. We're counting down top four episodes of the out of the 39 live ones we did this year. This is your episode 3.
Number 3.
All right. This was August 28th. August 28th, the end of Aug, the end of Augie Doggy, certainly.
We were
definitely in the throes of Augie Doggy at this point.
So wait, okay.
End of August.
Was this San Diego?
No, sir. San Diego Comic-Con.
End of August. End of August, we were in Australia.
That's right. We were in Australia. This is the episode from Sydney, Australia.
G'day.
G'day.
So this made the best of, well, we didn't vote on the, when we did the Howl wrap up.
Yeah.
For the,
that wasn't a countdown.
We just decided what the best
this
was.
This wasn't a countdown.
Don't call it a countdown.
Uh-huh.
We just decided what we thought the best of was, right?
No, we just went through the episodes. We didn't
wasn't
really.
Wasn't it called a best of though?
It was a best of, but we may have cut out some. I don't know, Paul. We're in the middle of this best of. Can we just focus on this one?
Fair enough, bro.
This is You, Paul F. Tompkins. Hi. Lauren Lapkus went on this leg of the tour, and also Mike Hanford.
Hey, man.
Was here with us, and we were joined by a very special guest, Claudia O'Doherty.
That's correct.
You heard her earlier in the countdown with Weird Al and Jessica McKenna, and she is from Australia, and I just reached out to her and said, you know what? I wonder if she'll be in Australia. I don't know how often she goes to Australia. Turns out she only goes twice a year for 1 week at a time, so I had a 1 in 26 chance. Oh. And she happened to be in Sydney on the day we were playing Sydney.
She had just gotten back.
She had just gotten back that day. She had just flown in, I believe, that morning. Mm-hmm. And she decided to appear on the show and was a great addition and gave the people in Sydney a thrill. She was treated like a rock star there.
Yes, she was. And deservedly so.
Deservedly so. Now, this is we'll hear a little bit from Claudia. I don't know who you're playing. Who are you playing in this? I don't have it in the notes.
Andrew Lloyd Webber.
That's right, Andrew Lloyd Webber. And I can't remember who Lauren is.
Oh, who Lauren was maybe Todd?
Maybe Todd, maybe I can't remember. But I do know that Mike Hanford is going to be Calvin Redding.
That's right.
One of the most exasperating characters. Oh. By the way, when you hear this, it's about 1,100 people in the crowd. We arrived at the venue to find that, unlike what is required by the contracts, there were no seats in the venue.
Yes, and
that
standing room only.
It was a standing venue, like a rock club.
Yes.
An 1,100 seat theater, everyone was standing. And we had two openers.
Yeah.
We had Mike Hanford as the normal opener, and then we also had another opener who did like 15 minutes, local stand-up.
In retrospect, we probably didn't have to send Mike out there.
Probably not. Yeah, we could have just come out.
Because you said that one guy who was like a part of the deal that we had no control over.
Right.
Who was perfectly fine.
Who was perfectly fine. So and then we did a two-hour show, I believe,
with an intermission, too.
Was it with an intermission?
We had to have an intermission.
Right. So this was so long, and this is at we'll first hear from Claudia, but when you listen to Mike at the end, just put yourself in the mind of you're a standing audience member who's been there for 3.5 hours.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. This is your number three.
Number three.
Oh, exasperating. Is it not?
That character.
The hay salesman.
Who debuted?
In
Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
It's a unique gift that Mike has that he's able to be so calmly boring and and come up with in the most inane details.
Yeah.
It's really, I mean, it's an amazing thing.
It is. It's kind of like the game that Harris played the first time he did Carl Jr., where he said, I want to come in and do an anti-character who never says anything interesting.
Yeah.
And he couldn't help himself, and he said he just kept thinking of jokes and made that character really funny.
Yeah.
But the challenge at first was to be very boring and mundane.
Yeah.
But Mike is doing sort of that and not having an interesting story that progresses, but doing it in a slightly different way.
Yeah.
It's very interesting.
And it's because it's like Mike has this ability to make it seem like the guy thinks this stuff is interesting.
Right.
And then it's all these details are very important.
Very important to him.
Yeah.
And yet he, the performer, knows that none of them are interesting.
Yeah.
It's a very interesting balance.
Yeah.
All right. Let's take a break. When we come back, we are going to hear the number eight, and we're going to have a little surprise for you for this holiday
for
season.
Me?
Well, no. You know what it is, actually.
So, fuck.
But for everyone listening, sorry.
Shit.
Sorry. All right. Let's take a break. We'll be right back with Comedy Bang Bang.
Sorry.
Comedy Bang Bang, back here with Paul F. Tompkins.
I'm back here with Scott Aukerman.
And
what a coincidence.
Wow, it really is. And boy, we are, I mean, I hate to say it again, but we are balls deep in this top 10.
We are.
Actually.
Our penises being dissolved by stomach lining.
Actually, let's not say we're balls deep in it, because now that I think about it, balls deep would be number one. Like, think of...
I guess so.
Think of the listeners as a 10-inch penis.
Sure, and I do.
We are 3 inches deep.
I'm imagining a 10-inch penis with headphones on. Is that weird?
I like it, though.
I bet you do.
Is that a shirt?
Freak.
Yeah. We're 3 inches deep, trying to get balls deep.
7 inches to go.
Mm-hmm. So let us get to it. This is your episode 8.
Number 8.
All right, this is from June 2.
2nd of June.
2nd of June.
2016.
Mm-hmm. You're nowhere around the studio at this point.
That's right. Where am I?
I don't know. Where are you on June 2? Do you have a calendar where you could look it up?
I do.
Look it up, Polly. Oh, look it up.
Oh, this is what it feels like.
Look it up, Polly. Look
it
up.
This is exciting.
Look it up, Polly. Look it up. Look it up, Polly. Look it up.
Look at the wrong month.
Look it up, Polly. Look it up.
Oh.
Look it up, Where were you?
Where were you? I was at the dentist in the morning.
Ooh, ouchie.
Yep.
That was it?
That was it.
And then you took the day off.
I took the rest of the damn day off.
You're one of those guys. Hey, I got a dentist appointment. Clear my schedule.
That's right.
Just in case.
That's right.
Just in case you're not going to be able to talk.
Well, just in case they take my tonsils out and then I have to watch soap operas and eat ice cream.
Do you think that every time you go into the dentist office, you're going to regrow your tonsils and you're going to need to take them out?
I still have my tonsils.
You do? Really?
Yes, I do.
I believe I still have one or two of them.
Still have my
They took some out, but then they left some
I think
some
you
in.
Only have two tonsils.
Okay. So that's what I said. Or I believe I have one or two of them.
Now that I say that, though, I don't know.
I think you have four, don't you? Oh, my God.
I don't know.
Now,
you look it up, Scotty. Yeah. Look it up. Look it up, Scotty. Look it up. Look it up, Scotty. Look it up.
We're already being told by
five.
Five?
Yep, five. Most people have five tonsils. These include.
Ew!
Yep.
These include what?
The first one. The second one. Single pharyngeal tonsil, often referred to as the adenoid,
oh.
Located in the posterior wall of the upper part of the throat.
Gross.
A pair of palatine tonsils is found at the back of the mouth. A pair of lingual tonsils is located at the base of the tongue.
Like Emperor Palatine?
Yes, from Star Wars.
My tonsils.
Yeah. So
I still have my tonsils. I still have my appendix.
So do I.
Still have my wisdom teeth.
And your virginity, your V card.
I know. And I'll never surrender it. Except in heaven.
Wait, you're going to fuck
waiting,
in heaven?
I'm waiting until I go to heaven and have
Who
sex.
Who are you going
to
fuck in heaven?
Anybody.
God?
Fingers crossed.
Do you think that God, if when you get up to heaven, God would let you fuck him?
That's the
ultimate.
Here's the thing. And I'm not trying to sound full of myself.
Sure.
God is... an asexual,
sure.
Omnipotent being.
Sure, and presumably when we get up to heaven, we will no longer have gender identities.
Right. But I think he'd be, I think he'd want to have sex with her.
I think that he would be into it.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Yeah, I don't know.
I mean, look,
we'll see what happens.
It's heaven, so great things are up there. What's greater than fucking
yes.
God?
Yes!
At last!
At last!
I got to fuck God! All right, let's get to it. This is from June 2. This is an episode called Sunday Afternoon Taped. Now, this is a bunch of people. This is Andy Samberg.
Sure.
From Saturday Night Live and Brooklyn Nine-Nine. Mm-hmm. This is Claudia O'Doherty. We've been hearing a lot from her.
COD.
And this is Nick Kroll.
Mm-hmm.
And this was an episode... I can really only get Andy about once a year. He's very busy. He's one of the hardest working guys in the world. Produces Brooklyn Nine-Nine as well. Has to be there all the time.
And he also sews sneakers.
He sews sneakers, yes, in China. And he's constantly flying back and forth. And those are two more than full-time jobs.
Yeah. He made my iPad.
He did.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's got tiny fingers.
Yeah.
That's the thing. Watch Brooklyn Nine-Nine and take a look at his hands and his fingers. Tiny, tiny fingers.
But they taper down perfectly. So
exactly.
That it's like, it almost looks like they kind of sharp point.
It's like Lady Deathstrike or something.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So, can only get him once a year. We got him. And when you do get him, it's at weird times.
Oh.
And
when you do get him, it's great.
when you do get him,
it's weird times.
No, it's usually weird times. And the other interesting part about his appearances, he sets them at a time and then normally will call you an hour before and go, hey, I just got off. Can we do it now? And then which forcing me to wrangle all of the other participants to say, can you come earlier? So I believe this was one of those times.
Why can't he wait the hour?
I don't know.
What?
Because it's like, I just got off Brooklyn Nine-Nine. If I just go home, I'm going to fall asleep or die. Yes, if I go home, I'll die. That's a good horror movie. If I go home, I'll die.
If I go home, I'll die. It's very easy not to do.
So this has happened probably five times where I've called the other person. Sometimes it's Adam Pally. I go, Adam, how soon can you get here? It definitely happened with this
time.
Can
you get back into character as bro?
It happened. This bro came back this year, by the way. We'll see if that ends up on the countdown. It happened this time where I believe it was 8 o'clock is when we scheduled it. And then it was like, hey, it's 7. Can we all meet? Got everyone around. He had just gotten off work. Most of us had just gotten off work. We usually don't do the late night ones. And then we found out that Earwolf had a keg tapped. What, Engineer Cody, what do you call it? It's what is
keg
it?
Keg stand.
It's a keg stand. And there, what kind of beer is in there?
Yellow.
I can't recall.
It's some kind of beer. We found that out that night, and we said, oh, well, it's night. Why don't we have a drink? And Andy had given up gluten, and it was the first time he'd had a beer in like a year or something like that. We all immediately got buzzed that quick from one beer and a very loopy energy, and it kind of took over the episode. Andy's himself, Claudia's herself, or her character of herself, I myself, and then Nick Kroll comes in as R. Schrift, his Australian character. Very ballsy to do an Australian character in front of Claudia.
Absolutely.
In front of an actual Australian.
Absolutely.
But she enjoys it, so hey, who are we to judge? All right, so let's hear it. This is R. Schrift. This is your episode 8.
Number 8.
All right, Sunday afternoon taped.
Just crazy.
Craziness. Just people having a good time.
Just people having a good time.
Not one of the most polished episodes of all time, but it's just funny people getting together and enjoying.
Compared to what? What are the polished episodes? Yeah,
maybe this one.
Oh, good point.
Speaking of polish,
it's polish time.
It's polish time. Stop. Polish time.
Please polish. Don't hurt him.
I don't know what the segue could possibly be when I say speaking of polish, but I was going to say, let's polish off something that we talked about last year.
Absolutely.
What do you say? Now, last year.
At this time,
we were recording the best ofs, and I don't recall how we got into it, but do you recall? Because you've listened to it.
I've listened to it. I just listened to it yesterday.
Right.
And I cannot tell you how.
Why we were talking about
it.
Yes. Okay, good. We, in the best ofs last year, go ahead, listen to it. We'll wait. We decided, we hit upon something called please.
Well, it started as a plea.
Okay.
This Christmas, don't joke about iRobot.
I don't remember why.
The movie
iRobot.
Talking
about the movie iRobot.
2004 adaptation of Isaac Asimov's story starring Will Smith. It was a moderate success, I guess. It was not like a huge bomb.
Not beloved, no.
It was not really talked about.
Strangely enough, I believe I auditioned to be the robot in that.
The titular robot?
Yes, the titular robot himself.
The one who goes, I, robot?
And you, man, I auditioned to be the robot in that. And the whole time I was thinking, they're just going to cast some big actor as this, which they ended up doing, I believe, right?
Is there I would assume there's more than one robot in the film.
Yeah, there's a million robots, but there's like the main robot.
The iRobot.
The iRobot. Let me look up who the iRobot.
Look it up, Scotty. Look it up. 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 Look it up, Scotty. Look it up.
I think it was Alan Tudyk.
Oh, sure. He's good.
Yeah, he's great.
Yeah, he's terrific.
Yeah, been on Bang Bang. But he wasn't famous at the time. I don't know why.
Oh, fuck no. You could have, I mean.
I could have gotten it.
Anybody could have gotten it, but you, I guess.
I guess I didn't. Wait, I didn't get it, right?
You didn't get it.
I'm not that robot.
Did you hear that you were still in the mix?
I might be.
Last I heard, I'm still in the mix for Men in Black 2. Never heard otherwise.
What about that 21 Jump Street crossover with Men in Black? Isn't that the weirdest project you've ever heard of? Yes. Yeah,
don't do that.
Because Hollywood. They're both owned by Sony, they're going to do a crossover?
Hollywood, don't do strange. That. Don't do that.
Hollywood, don't do that. All right. So we were talking about iRobot. We said, please don't make fun of iRobot this Christmas.
By the way, we were barely talking about iRobot. We mentioned the title. We weren't talking about the movie. Look, we just had to look up who was another person in it.
Yeah, I don't know why we got on this, but we started saying, please don't joke
about iRobot
this Christmas. And then we said that would make a good song.
Yeah.
And then we said, hey, everyone, remind us next year that we want to actually record this song.
Yeah. We stipulated that it would be a country song.
Yep. Country and Western.
With a spoken word interlude.
Sure. I believe we said it was going to be like a We Are the World kind of situation where we got a bunch of people to sing on it. That did not happen.
That spoiler alert, did not happen.
But we are going to sing.
This is the debut. This is the
debut of our brand new single.
That's right. This will be, look, cut this out, save it as an MP3, mm-hmm. make this a staple of your Christmas listening from now on.
Christmas is right around the corner, literally days away.
The goose is getting fat.
Please put one penny in the old man's hat.
If you haven't got a penny, a hay penny will do.
Hey, you know what? If you haven't got a hay penny, fuck you!
Yeah, get the fuck out of here!
I'm sorry. For the radio, forget you! We're going to do it. We actually did it. Paul, you wrote this song, and Eben Schletter wrote the music and has created a backing track for this. We're actually going to do it.
We're going to do it.
So, guys, being as we are just on the cusp of Christmas, a Christmas Eve, if you will.
We're on a Christmas cusp.
Here's a special holiday classic for you and your asses. This is Please Don't Joke About iRobot This Christmas. Hit it!
Don't have to wrap a gift for me, and you don't have to put lights on a tree, but I've got one request you must not dismiss. Please don't joke about iRobot this Christmas. Please don't joke about iRobot this Christmas. That's the cruelest thing that you could do. Please don't joke about iRobot this Christmas. 'Cause iRobot would not joke about you.
You can sing a carol in the snow, gain a bunch of weight and laugh ho ho ho. You can drink 10,000 mugs of Swiss Miss, but please don't joke about iRobot this Christmas.
Please don't joke about iRobot this Christmas. That's the cruelest thing that you could do. Please don't joke about iRobot this Christmas. Oh, 'cause iRobot would not joke about you.
iRobot was released in 2004, and as of this recording, has a 58% score on the Rotten Tomatoes movie website. That means half of audiences liked it just fine. There were way worse movies released that year. National Treasure, for instance. Maybe make fun of that one instead. How about The Polar Express? Pretty creepy. M. Night Shyamalan's The Village, for crying out loud. Hey, White Chicks. Come on. White Chicks is better than iRobot? Get out of town. So this year, As you gather around the Christmas tree to open your presents, just this one time, don't joke about iRobot.
Give a man of snow a carrot nose.
Squeeze the baby Jesus's whittle toes.
But should you ignore my warning, you'd be remiss.
Please don't joke about iRobot this Christmas. Please don't joke about iRobot this Christmas. That's the cruelest thing that you can do. Please don't joke about iRobot this Christmas. 'Cause iRobot would not joke about you. iRobot would not joke about you.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Oh, a Yuletide classic.
Instant Yuletide classic.
I have a tear in my eye.
I have a tear in my beer because I'm thinking of you, dear.
I hope people take it to heart. I think anyone who, first of all, any monster who sits around the Christmas table and decides to joke about iRobot.
Joking about it.
Come on. It's the Christmas holiday season. Let's leave some of these movies alone.
When I first was writing the lyrics, I wrote, I remembered it as, please don't make fun of iRobot.
Right.
So this isn't even that. This is, don't just joke about iRobot.
Don't be like, hey, remember that time we went to see iRobot and your aunt was did something crazy?
Hey, don't joke about iRobot.
Don't joke about iRobot.
Please. It's Christmas.
Well, guys, I hope you take that to heart, and I hope you have a lovely Christmas. But we're not done with our countdown. We still have two episodes to go next week before, in between Christmas and New Year's Eve. So are you ready for those? We're going to be going and doing number 7 through number 1.
I guess I'll have to be ready.
You're going to have to be ready because it's going to happen.
Yeah, yeah.
Paul, like thanks for writing. Yeah, just like death. Thank you so much for writing that song. I hope people enjoyed it.
Oh, and thank you to Evan Schletter for turning that music around so fast.
In literally, I think, 12 hours, did a full, complete demo.
Absolutely.
Beautiful, beautiful. Yes. All right, we'll see you on Monday for the rest of the countdown. Until then, have a wonderful Christmas. Thanks, bye. You've heard of Asimov's 3 laws of robotics, but I bet you never heard his 4th law, which was mostly just how to clean their robotic sex holes. Welcome to Comedy Bang Bang. Bernard Shakey, another catchphrase superstar, thank you so much. And I picked that because of Asimov.
Right.
And welcome to Comedy Bang Bang for the 3rd of our best ofs, 3rd of 4. And if you were listening to, by the way, I'm Scott Aukerman, your host. And if you were listening.
By the way,
very important to say. If you were listening to our previous installment, speaking of Asimov, we sang our wonderful Christmas hit, which took over the nation, called Please Don't Joke About iRobot This Christmas.
That's right.
I hope that you sang it with your family around the hearth.
And listen, it's not just for Christmas celebrators.
Nope.
It can also be Hanukkah.
Because it's talking, yeah, well, that's true. But also, it's not just for Christmas Day, because it's saying this Christmas, don't do that, which can be any time of year from December 26th on.
That's right.
A year-round classic.
It can go from December 26th to December 25th.
But no one sing then it on December 25th.
Do not sing it on December 25th.
Because it's Christmas already, you doy-doys.
I'm the Scat Man. Remember that guy?
No, who's that?
This guy called himself the Scat Man, and he had a song.
And it's not Scat Man Crothers?
It's not Scat Man Crothers.
How dare he?
Scat Man Crothers was just a Scat Man.
He wasn't the Scat
Man. He made the mistake of not calling himself
the Scat Man. He's one of several Scat Men.
The Scat Man was a guy who had this weird novelty hit where he scatted like crazy.
Okay.
And the backstory—
And that wasn't sustainable for a long music career?
Well, the backstory on that guy was that he was a lifelong stutterer and worked to cure himself of his stutter or manage his stutter.
Well, scatting is the stutter of music.
Is that— Do you really feel that way?
I really do feel that way. I'm sorry. And I'm sorry if it's just the way I was raised.
You tell it like it is. And you say what's on your mind. Mm-hmm. And you say what everyone else is thinking.
Uh-huh. And in this PC culture, it's kind of refreshing, isn't it?
PC culture is the biggest threat to America today. Yep.
What about Russia?
I mean, that's up there. But honestly, those red cups at Starbucks that don't say Christmas on them.
Usually I like a red cup.
Right?
You know, at a, some sort of like keg party.
A red solo cup.
Yeah, you know what I mean? Put my lean in it.
That's a great thing in country songs is modern country songs just name-checking things.
Things, yeah. We all, these are things that exist.
Exactly.
Kitchens.
Here's things we like. I like this, I like that, I like the other thing too. Here's some country people from long ago that I talk about.
Yep.
Yeah.
By the way, Paul F. Tompkins is here. Hello,
Hi,
Paul.
I'm me.
I am me and I am him.
I like me. My wife likes me.
You both like you.
That's from Planes, Trains, and Automobiles.
Oh, is it?
Very sad scene with John Candy.
Oh, yeah.
Rest in power.
Rest in power. He's pretending his wife's still alive, right?
What about rest in poutine for Canadian people?
Hey, I like it. Rest in Putin.
Rest in Putin. Putin. Putin.
Remember Putin. Wouldn't George, be Putin.
George W. Bush would say
Wouldn't Putin. Be Putin.
Wouldn't be. Nagada.
Nagada. Nagada. Nagada.
That was a thing that came up a lot on tour with me, you, and Lauren was we kept doing Dana Carvey's George Bush.
Why?
Impression.
I don't remember
I
that.
I don't know why.
We were? Nagada.
Yeah, it was a thing that would come up periodically. It wouldn't linger.
Nagada.
But it's Nagada.
It was like not like the Cranberries.
They had to let it
live. It was compulsory.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's an Irish thing. It's in their culture.
Nagada.
Nagada.
Nagada. So, Paul, it's Monday. We just had Christmas and, of course, Hanukkah.
Still going strong. We're in the throes of Hanukkah.
We were in the throes of Augie Doggy for a while, and now it's in the throes of Honey Doggy. Hope you're enjoying your honey doggy. Yes!
I love kosher honey doggies.
Kosher honey doggies.
Oh, every year at this time.
Kosher honey doggies.
You gotta be tearing me down.
What, you know.
Did I do for Hanukkah? Well, I'm glad you asked. I, of course, lit the candles. Mm-hmm. I said the prayers.
Yep.
What are your prayers? Socks and underwear.
Oh, okay.
What are my prayers for Hanukkah?
Yeah.
I hope that things continue to go in a good way for the Jewish people.
That's right. And what way is that?
Up, 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 baby.
Hey.
All the way to the top.
Yep. Through the roof.
Chosen people.
Jews through the stratosphere.
Jews through the stratosphere. I like it. Jews through the stratosphere.
Next year in Israel, Jews through the stratosphere. Two great slogans.
It's the natural. I feel like Jews through the stratosphere is the completion of the phrase. Yep. Next year in Israel, Jews through the stratosphere. Jews through the stratosphere.
What? New Year's Eve coming up, obviously.
What are you doing New Year's Eve?
Maybe it's much too early in the game, but I don't know. I thought I'd ask you just the same. What are you doing New Year's Eve?
Oh, I turn right back around on
you. Yeah, I don't like to let anyone know my location.
Oh, you're very secretive.
I am not going to be in this country, I'll tell you that much.
Are you worried about murderers?
I am, yeah. I'm mainly worried about manslaughterers. That's why I'm taking along my friend Jessica Fletcher.
I forgot about manslaughter.
Well, it was 8 million years ago that we talked about it.
Really? Oh, my God.
Remember when we also taped the Christmas episode
right.
this morning?
Scott and I have spent a calendar day together.
Oh.
Manslaughter, she wrote.
Manslaughter, she wrote. Good stuff. Hey, I got to talk about it because it's a Christmas tradition.
You gotta. Come on, man.
And we flirted with it a couple episodes
Ooh
ago.
La la.
Mr. Microphone.
Yes. The year. 1985. 1978.
I looked it up. Let me be on. Okay.
You looked it up, Scotty.
I looked it up, Scotty. Can I fill people in on what we're talking about? For the past couple of best ofs, we have strangely hit upon, by mere coincidence, we talked about the Mr. Microphone commercial from the 70s and 80s on two separate occasions for some reason. Mm-hmm. And to me, I have to say one thing that I am very disappointed with in the holidays now that was one of my favorite cherished traditions is I would watch the holiday episode of David Letterman, and I would look forward to three things. I would look forward to Jay Thomas coming out and telling the Lone Ranger story.
That's right.
I would look forward to him trying to hit the pizza and meatballs off a Christmas tree with a football. And Darlene Love singing White Christmas.
That's right. Christmas Baby, Please Come Home.
Oh, that's right. So sorry. And I would always love to see whatever art direction they did. I remember one year, the person playing saxophone on the saxophone solo, a big giant throne turned around and he was sitting in it and he got up and danced around. These are the things that I enjoy. When I realized we had somehow inadvertently hit upon our own Christmas tradition by chance talking about the Mr. Microphone commercial on two consecutive best of episodes, I realized we had to keep it going. And I realized we had to, and here's what it stems from. There is a phrase in these commercials. Paul, maybe you want to say exactly what it is.
The phrase is, hey, good looking, we'll be back to pick you up later.
Mm-hmm. Sometimes I'll, sometimes we'll. Mm. And I'll tell you why I know that. In previous years, and this comes up, we'll say, hey, good looking, I'll be back to pick you up later. Or, hey, good looking, we'll be back to pick you up later. And that just came up two different years, and then we broke down the commercial and our problems with it.
Yeah.
Now, I have not seen this commercial in 30 years. Mm-hmm. It has just been seared into my brain.
Me too.
And my issue with the Mr. Microphone product is this. I would watch the commercial, and this is what I would imagine is that I would be in a situation where I would buy a Mr. Microphone. I would find some good-looking women walking down the street listening to their radios.
Yeah.
And I would turn on my microphone and take over their radio.
That's right.
And out of their radio, they would hear my voice, and I would say, hey.
Your message.
My message. And I'd be on message and on brand by saying, hey, good-looking, I'll be back to pick you up later.
Sure.
And I was very disappointed when I got a Mr. Microphone that it only broadcast. It does not broadcast to random radio signals. That would be insane.
Yeah.
If you could usurp anyone's radio at any time.
It's not Mr. Pirate Microphone.
No. It's not some sort of Christian Slater pump up the volume situation with pirate radio. No. One had to turn their radio to a specific frequency on the radio dial, normally very, very low, some like 86.9, something that no one would be listening to.
Because there's nothing there.
There's nothing there, and that's why they pick it. It is attuned to that frequency. Instead, pick 102.7 or something like that, something, you know, Kiss FM, something everyone is listening to. But no, they pick it very low on the frequency. So it only works if you turn your own radio onto this, and it will be broadcast on this. Yeah. And this was my issue. I had been watching this commercial for years and years, and I had—
Because they did use the same commercial for a very long time.
For a very long time. And I had imagined in my mind a situation where I would be throwing my voice like a ventriloquist, a Mr. Microphone ventriloquist, into other people's radios.
Or like a terrifying big brother who controlled all methods of communication.
Sure, certainly.
One of those.
Yes. Now, I've talked about my disappointment with the product 2 years in a row, and it came to my attention through sharp-eared listeners that the—
Bats.
That the commercial does not imply that you would be throwing your voice into another radio.
Yeah.
It implies that you would have your own radio and turn it up so loudly that when you said, hey, good looking, I'll be back to pick you up later.
And Steph Curry for Steve.
What are you doing? Cody, this is the literally 10th time you have interrupted our show by watching something on the computer while you are supposed to be recording the show.
It's sort of astonishing that you still have a job here.
You're one of our oldest employees, and I love you.
This is your most reliable trait, by the way.
This is something that you do. I cannot fathom it. I cannot fathom. I'm right in the middle of one of our cherished Christmas traditions.
Cody, people look forward to this all year long.
All year long. And here I am in the middle of it.
People have just gotten their families gathered around.
Around the
their
hearth.
Laptop.
I'm about to make a mea culpa apology.
This has been a long time coming. Oh,
3 years in the making.
Yes.
And now I have to hear about Steph Curry? What do you have to say for yourself?
I'm so sorry.
Thank you. That's a start. That's a start. And it may be, quite honestly, a finish. We'll see. Mm. 2017. Mm. I do not have the power to fire you.
Full disclosure. No one in this room has power to fire Cody. That would explain a great deal.
But look, one can only control one's own radio. And one hopes that one has a loud enough radio.
As scripture tells us.
That one can turn it up loud enough to broadcast one's own voice to a good-looking woman as one passes by one. And that would be so distracting to them that they would look up.
So distracting.
One would think that they would have their own radios that they're listening to and not hear something like this. Although, when you are listening to the radio, one should be attuned to the noises around them, especially if there are cars about.
Yeah, if you're walking around carrying a radio and holding it right up to your ear.
Sure. As pop culture in the 80s and 70s showed us. A lot of people would do this.
A lot of people would do this.
Right up to the ear.
It's your responsibility to be alert and aware of your surroundings.
With one ear.
With one ear.
Listen for car sounds.
So.
And even if you're indoors, look, there are a lot of news stories every year about cars crashing into mini marts, houses.
Yeah.
I saw Straight Outta Compton. Those guys, very first scene, boom. Right in the living room. So,
now, can you imagine you're in your living room, you're listening to your radio, you're not paying attention because you think, oh, I'm in my house.
I'm in my house. Of course a car is not going to come crashing
through.
That's
when you have to pay attention the most.
The most, because that's when you least expect it. One ear, always for car sounds.
So then what, you're going to let yourself be manslaughtered? And then Jessica Fletcher has to come in on her goddamn bike?
Vehicular manslaughter, she wrote.
Oh,
not this Christmas. So what happened was...
Here it comes, the big moment everyone's been waiting for.
I got this news. I heard, hey, you're wrong about this commercial, which is seared into your brain.
Mm-hmm.
My brain, specifically. So many times I've watched this commercial, and that was my impression of the Mr. Microphone.
Mm-hmm.
I've come to realize that, no. When you watch the commercial, I pulled up the actual commercial... And I think this cannot be the version that I watched so many times.
Here's the version that I remember that's seared into my brain.
Okay.
There is a young lady walking down the street. There are three guys in a convertible. They have a Mr. Microphone. The one guy says, via his car radio, hey, good looking, we'll be back to pick you up later.
Okay. Now, see, that is the version in my brain too, but the only one, the original... That is online. There are two commercials that I found online. The only one that features a car of gentlemen saying that, they never show the women. They never show the women.
You just see these three assholes?
You just see these
going,
three
hey,
assholes.
Good looking, we'll be back to pick you up later.
Yes. And I thought to myself, can that be possible that we are remembering women, beautiful women walking down the street and then... This and then them being a reaction, but maybe.
Here's what's very, I think, a comfort.
Mm-hmm.
How progressive that commercial was back then.
To not show.
Not show the gender.
The gender.
They didn't show the gender of the person.
Oh,
that
that's
true. That was the good looking one.
Maybe. You're right.
It could be a man, could be a woman.
That's true. That is a great
So
great
it
point.
Allowed you to put yourself in, if I may, the driver's seat.
Right.
What if you were that man with the Mr. Microphone? Who's the good looking person you're seeing?
These days it's anything. Is it a table? You know? It's like who knows what people are in love with these days? I don't know.
I don't think they were yelling at a table.
maybe he's going antiquing. And he's like, hey, good looking. I'll be back to pick you up later.
Like people have put their stuff by the side.
Yeah, it's a garage sale.
Yeah.
I don't know. Anyway, I think there has to be a later version of this commercial where you see the women. I think because here – and
I can see it in my mind very clearly.
I can too. But here's another thing that I found out about this year. That there is a theory. I have always said ever since I was a young man, the Berenstain Bears.
Yes.
We've talked about this a little.
And I talked about this on my show with with someone else.
We may have talked about it on tour and that, or maybe we did not talk about it.
I don't remember talking about this with you.
Okay, I've read this, but okay. So I've said the Berenstain Bears forever, growing up. I was shocked to find that it is the Bernstein Bears.
Oh, see, I thought it was the Berenstain Bears. Oh, the mummy.
Hold on. Let's look it up.
Look it up, Scotty. Look it up.
It is the Berenstain Bears.
Oh. But why does that sound familiar?
But, okay, it's the Berenstain Bears, but I have always thought it was the Berenstein Bears.
Because that's a name that you've maybe is closer to a name you've heard before.
Yeah. Now, there's a theory online.
Who ends their name in Stain? It's crazy.
There are so many people, apparently, who think it is the Berenstein Bears, yes. Spelled S-T-E-I-N, not A-I-N, which is what it is. There are so many people that think it is the Berenstein Bears that they believe time travelers have gone back in time and changed it to Berenstain Bears.
Why?
And we all still retain our memories.
Why would they do that?
I don't know. But that is what I think may be happening here with the Mr. Microphone. Until and some of you people out there may be able to send us a later version of this commercial. I'll talk about the later version that I did find in a minute. But the version that I saw from 1978 is so old and shitty that it can't be the version that we saw so many times as a kid. Can it?
Why? Why can't it be?
It starts off, it looks so bad. Mm-hmm. It starts off with two just dopes going, "Hey, what do you got there? Oh, well, Mr. Microphone. Oh, I heard of that." It's so bad.
Here's all I remember is the guys in the car and the ladies who apparently did not exist.
Right.
And the guy with his radio on his shoulder who is walking down the street singing Jingle Bells.
I don't know about Jingle Bells. There's a guy, there is an African-American gentleman who's like dancing with his ghetto blaster next to his ear and singing into a microphone at one point.
Yes.
I think there must be a version from 1983 or so that upgraded all of these scenes that we're just not seeing. Anyway, this is a mystery for next year's Best Ofs. Hopefully some people will do a little research. Now, I was like, this can't be the commercial that I've seen. So I did a little research and I found a version from 1981 or two. Which upgrades the look of the commercial considerably. It looks like a professional commercial again. Right. But the "Hey, good looking," the "Hey, good looking, I'll be back to pick you up later," is said by a child on a bike.
Now, I think then that's a reference to the original iconic commercial. And they were having some fun with it.
They're having some fun where they were saying like, oh, even kids can be.
Even kids want to fuck.
And that's what we want to say this Christmas. Even kids want to fuck.
So let them.
Let them, let moms.
Let kids fuck each other.
What if kids just, what if it was like 1 year on January 1st, 2017, every elementary school.
This is a purge scenario?
Yeah. This is it's not even a purge scenario, but it's like on January 1st, everyone said, look, we know it's New Year's Day. Get your kids in school. I know they traditionally have it off on January 1st.
Right.
Get everyone come to the school because we have something important to say. And every single principal of every single elementary school said, guys, it's no longer, we're not going to look down on you guys anymore. In fact, we encourage you, all of you kids, fuck each other. All the time.
All of you small children, you are free to be sexually active.
Do whatever you want. We're not, there are no rules anymore.
But look, the only rule is it's got to be consensual.
It's got to be consensual, of course. And have fun.
And have fun.
What do you think would happen?
What do I think? What happened?
And how would they all coordinate?
Would the parents all go along with it?
Yeah, like, they all.
Well, if all the schools got together and said, it's okay.
Anyway, oh, the other weird part about this.
Anyway, yeah.
The other strange part about this second Mr. Microphone commercial is there is a section where it is a group of Hispanic people sitting around, and it says, Señor Microfono es número uno. And, very weird.
And do they, are they then singing a song in Spanish?
They're not, they're like going, yay, into their own, or they're going, I don't know.
They're just cheering for the Mr. Microphone.
Yeah, for the Mr. Microphone. And then there's another scene where a 12-year-old girl is at her birthday party, and she has a stack of presents, and she's opened 10 of them, and 9 are Mr. Microphones. And she opens another one and goes, another Mr. Microphone! Yay! And everyone cheers.
That's I think at that point, the makers of Mr. Microphone were being...
They're stretching the truth little bit.
Come on, guys.
A wee little bit. Come on, guys.
Wow.
Now, do you have anything to add to the Mr. Microphone mythos?
I was obsessed with it as a child. Never had one.
Never had one, yeah.
I don't even know if I ever saw one in person.
I don't think I had, by the way, the actual legit Ronco Mr. Microphone. I believe I had – my sister, I believe, got a Barbie version. And I was like, oh, boy, one of these that I have coveted for so long so I could tell women everywhere that I was going to pick them up later.
So that you'll never know the powers of the real Mr. Microphone.
I don't know what radius it would broadcast to. So much is
probably unsaid. Miles.
Probably.
Yeah, I assume. I mean, I'd love to wonder, having never experienced it.
Yeah, that's true.
I want to look up those commercials because I have not. I also have not seen them in 30 years.
You'd be shocked at how bad the original one is. It is so shoddily made. There has to be a version from later on in the mid 80s that we watched. I don't know. There has to be. I pray there was.
This is my prayer.
All right. Well, we did it. We talked about it for another
year.
There
we go. The tradition has been fulfilled.
Yep. It's time to get to our countdown.
Light another candle.
If you're listening, this is, of course, our third episode of our Best of Countdown. We've been counting down the top 15 Comedy Bang Bang episodes of the year. And we in our last episode, we cracked the top 10. On this episode, we'll be hearing from episodes 7 through 4. This year, we have been counting down the top 4 live episodes of the year because we went on this multi-country tour to the Canada, as Lisa says, and Australia and the UK, and of course the US.
Of course the US. Don't forget the Motor City.
Hey, what about New Orleans? All we need is music.
We love it.
Century Boulevard?
We love it.
Look at that bum over there. He's down on his knees.
We love it.
We did 40 dates this year, so we did so many of those that we decided to count down the top 4 live episodes. So we'll be hearing our number 2 live episode this time. So that's exciting. Are you ready to get into the countdown?
Yeah.
Okay, let's hear. This is episode number 7.
Number 7.
All right, this is episode number 7, and we've been talking over the past couple of episodes here that the early episodes don't get a lot of love. We do the countdown from Thanksgiving to Thanksgiving.
And it's understandable.
And it's the way of life. People like the more recent things that they've heard because they're more fresh in their mind and they forget about how good the older episodes are.
You know what, Scott? This makes me sick because people, this disposable culture where it's like, new,
I want it now.
A violent crumble.
Instant gratification. Make me come. Anyway, you know what I'm talking about, Paul.
I feel like that took a sharp turn.
But weirdly, this particular countdown, a lot of the early episodes are represented. It's almost like people have been keeping track of those early episodes saying, I got to remember to vote for them.
They took your admonishments to heart. Now, this is all you want out of entertainment, is that the people that provide the entertainment.
That when I scold
they
someone.
They scold you and it sticks.
Yeah. So this is episode 390 from December 7th of last year.
Whoa.
That's right.
Amazing. This is the earliest one, right?
This so far is the earliest
episode.
That's right after Thanksgiving, which was the countdown. And I do have to say, this is the earliest episode. So,
all right. So,
November 30th fans, sorry.
Sorry.
Sorry, Gilly. This is an episode called The Oh Hello Show.
Now, what's this one all about?
What do you think it might be about?
Probably Jason Manzoukas up to his usual tricks.
No, it's not
Andy
Jason
Daly.
Manzoukas. It is our good friend, Eugene Merman from New York.
Oh, sure.
Eugene Merman, every once in a while, he'll come out maybe once a year and he'll do an episode with us. And he came out this year in December and did one episode with us.
Eugene, it's fun and he's funny. I like being around him.
I like it. I like everything about it.
I like you.
I like you a lot. I love you.
I love you.
So it's Eugene Merman, and it's also Nick Kroll and John Mulaney.
Oh, hello.
At the time, they were just about – at the time of the recording, I believe they were just about to go out to New York to do the Oh, Hello show off-Broadway.
Yeah, and everyone told them, don't do that.
Don't do that. That'll never amount to anything.
About? Yeah.
And instead, it amounted to everything because they are currently in the middle of a sold-out Broadway run, which is acclaimed and has been extended.
And here's me. I'm wearing a barrel with suspenders.
Is your name J.C. Penney?
Sure it is.
Do you know that old joke?
No.
Guy or a kid, probably. I don't know. I heard it when I was a kid, so maybe I'm imagining it was a
guy
kid.
Or a kid.
Walking down the street, see someone with a great shirt on, says, where'd you get that shirt? And the person says, oh, J.C. Penney. And then walks down the street, sees a guy with a great pair of pants, goes, ooh, I love those pants. Where'd you get them? He goes, J.C. Penney. Walking down the street, sees a guy with a pair of shoes. Hey, where'd you get those shoes? J.C. Penney. Sees a guy walking down the street. He's got a barrel with suspenders. What's going on with you? He goes, my name's J.C. Penney.
People have stolen his clothes.
People have stolen his clothes, you see.
One item at a time.
Mm-hmm. I submitted
They've
that.
They've remained in the area.
Would it surprise you, Paul, to learn that I submitted that joke to Reader's Digest, laughter is the best medicine, as a child. You know what I'm talking about.
I know exactly what you're talking about. And I remember doing shit like that when I was a kid and how important it was.
Yes. And I would scour Reader's Digest every year.
To see your name in print in a magazine?
Oh, my God. How amazing would that? And now our names are in print in magazine. And we throw them away. And we're like, oh, God, another fucking magazine.
It disgusts me.
I need more room in my apartment for cat skeletons. So, laughter is the best medicine. Humor in uniform.
That's
I can't remember what the other ones were.
There was a
There were a few.
Of them.
And that was all I would read Reader's Digest for, would be those 5 pages of jokes that they would have. Anyway.
What was it like? Abortion doctor?
Abortion doctor? That was not a section in Reader's Digest.
It was jokes that were overheard at an abortion doctor.
No. They were medical
jokes,
though.
Yeah, they were medical jokes. They weren't about abortions.
But they were overheard at abortion clinics?
It was very specifically overheard at an abortion clinic.
Okay, I don't know that you're remembering this right.
I remember they were funny jokes.
But, all right, let's listen to this. This was Nick Kroll and John Mulaney, of course, playing their characters, George and Gil. Very popular now. They're on Broadway, and which is no surprise that they've been well represented on the countdown here. And we're going to hear a little bit of Gil and George talking about what they've been up to back last December. This is your episode 7.
Number 7.
Oh, boy.
Those guys.
They can go for hours. And I'd like them to.
They can go.
What were you guys?
Nothing.
Oh, Paul, can I talk to you
for a second? I'm happy for them. I'm happy for them.
Paul, I'm grabbing your arm. Can I go and can I talk to you for a second? Can they go what?
I was going to say a mean thing, and then I restrained myself.
Why would you say a mean thing to them?
Well, I mean, they got that Broadway run, and my play flopped.
What was your play again?
It was called Hamiltons.
Hamiltons.
Hamiltongs.
Hamiltongs.
Yes. It was about Alexander Hamilton making the perfect salad.
The inventor of the Caesar salad himself? Yeah. Alexander Hamilton?
Alexander Hamiltongs.
And this came out well after Hamilton.
Oh, so long after. Like, it had been an established hit.
Oh, yeah. Everyone knew it.
I'd never heard of it.
Mm.
And I thought, this is the time is right. The time is right.
The time is right for having fun and to dancing in the street. Don't forget the Motor City.
Yeah, you've
down
seen,
in New Orleans.
You've seen that video where they take the music out.
Oh, I was just referencing it yesterday.
It's tremendous.
It's so funny.
It's really
my favorite viral video of all time.
So good.
Yeah, other
so
than
good.
The Mr. Microphone video. All right. We need to take a break. When we come back, we're actually going to hear our live entry after this. This will be number 3 in our live entry. We will be right back with more Comedy Bang Bang after this. Comedy Bang Bang back here.
You startled me.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
Have you been here this whole time?
Wait, you feel like you've been doing the show alone?
I mean,
I'm not an imaginary person.
You're not Mr. Robot?
What's that?
Are you Mr. Robot?
What if one of us was an imaginary person to the other? How weird would that be? Aww. And that when people were listening to these episodes, it was just me rambling for a long time and then taking long breaks for pauses.
I'm the imaginary guy?
In my scenario, but in the opposite scenario.
What if I am imaginary?
That's true. I mean, you have all of the aspects of an imaginary person.
What does that mean?
You dress like an imaginary person.
That's what I thought.
You have
meant.
A big beard.
I don't want to have this beard.
I know. What do you have the beard for?
This for a bajillion.
Because bajillion last dollar time, properties.
Because the first couple seasons I had a fake beard, which added time to everyone's day.
Yeah. And you weren't able to be an hour late.
That's right.
And so you wanted the luxury.
That's right.
Of blaming Obama for
That's
traffic.
Right. That's right. Thanks, Obama. And so I thought, well, I'll just grow a beard. It'll be easier. Mm-hmm. And it is.
Does it hurt?
But it's so painful. It's so painful because it's growing back into my face.
Oof.
Yeah.
That's no good. Yeah. Serious question. Do you have to cut it every day in order to keep it the same length, or do you make the makeup
Not every
people
day.
Do that?
No, it's I think I've trimmed it a couple times since I started growing in August. Mm-hmm. But it's not uncomfortable or anything. I just don't like it.
Are you on the last day of shooting going to shave when they yell, and that is a season wrap on Paul F. Tompkins?
I thought about shaving at the wrap party.
Yeah. Oh, in front of everyone.
Taking some clippers and yeah. Yeah, yeah.
That'll slow the party down for a good
You don't think people
half
love
hour.
To see shit like that?
That's true.
When somebody gets a haircut, it's the best.
Wait, are you just
That's
hanging
why
around barbershops?
There's all these crowds around barbershops.
That's why they have clear windows, too.
Yeah. They know what side their bread is buttered on. People love watching other people's hair go away.
Go away. It's not going away. It's going onto the floor.
Oh, I never thought to look down.
Wait, you've never looked down on the floor?
It just
vanishes from your field of vision?
I just thought it went away.
Okay. Wait a minute. Can I ask you a question?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
When people drop money on the ground, do you think it just disappears as well? Are you dropping money on the ground? Have you ever dropped money?
Well, sometimes if I have too much money, I'm like, I got to get rid of this. I'll just send it to the away place. And I just let go of it with my fingers.
Have you ever had a pet? Have you ever had a pet?
Yeah, sure.
What kind of pet have you had?
Birds. Okay, they're in cages, those, you know.
Yeah, and they're in your...
Yeah, I've had all kinds of eye level
They're
pets.
Right at eye level. Yeah. Okay.
I remember having a cat that would appear and disappear periodically.
All right. I could do this for hours.
Come on, we have a good time.
All right.
We have a good time. Hold on. There's more time for this. Yeah.
Ding, 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 ding.
Oh, here's a serious entreaty to the audience. Mm-hmm. If someone could keep track of the sound effects we already have for the sound effects record.
Yes. What are they?
Well, I know we have water being poured into a glass many times.
Yes.
So we have a number of options to choose from when we finally put the album together of that track.
Right.
That's the only one I can remember now.
Yeah, I know. There's, of course, the train and the Doppler effect.
Ding, 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 ding.
Okay.
Okay, we got that.
That's not the train?
What do you mean that?
Are the train and the Doppler effect two separate sound effects?
Well, the sound of the train is experiencing the Doppler effect.
Yes.
One could not literally record the Doppler effect without recording the thing that is experiencing the Doppler effect.
Scott, I understand that. Mm-hmm. It was your phrasing of we have the train and the Doppler effect. That's what made me think that mm-hmm. you have, in your mind,
have another recorded two
track.
Things.
There's a track called the Doppler effect.
This is just combined. This
okay. Is, my mistake?
There could be two tracks, one train and one passing train,
Ooh,
which
you
would.
You see that viral video? Two tracks, one train?
So what was your entreaty, by the way? It was...
Please let us know what tracks we already have.
Already have.
Because we got to fill 99.
We
got
to fill 99 tracks, and we got to get to business on this.
Because I would eventually like to put out a sound effects record.
Much like Please Don't Joke About iRobot This Christmas, we need to get this out next year in the stores.
No, we're not going to get it out next year.
We're not going to get the sound effects record out next year?
I don't think we're going to
get
99.
Do you think
that'll
be the last episode that we ever record?
Yes.
We'll just be a sound effects record.
We'll just be the sound effects record. 99 sound effects in a row. Number one with a bullet. No, I think we said number 11 was the glass, yeah. Was the water in the glass.
Something like that. Yeah. I can't remember. Anyway, please let us know because we are struggling here.
We got a lot of tracks to put down. I can't even think of that many sounds. How many sounds are there?
I said there's birds. That's all I can
water
think of.
Water in a glass. The Doppler effect.
The end.
Princey's train.
Princey's train?
What? Princey's train. I love that movie.
Look, we got to get to our next clip.
We got!
All right. This is your number three.
Number three.
That's right. This is number three of the live tracks. And this is an interesting one, Paul. This is some of these picks for the live tracks are kind of atypical. Look, we did a ton of episodes.
We did.
And
but you're saying some people made, like the voters chose poorly.
No, they didn't choose poorly. Oh. What's interesting to me is we did so many episodes in a row in the U.S. tour.
Yes.
And not a lot of those made it, but these little interesting ones, Montreal, for instance, mm-hmm. with the Oh Hello guys. Mm-hmm. Sydney, you know, out there in the middle of nowhere.
Could I?
And then this one, this is the only one you weren't at, Paul. This is live from Comic-Con, July 25th.
Fuck this.
No, Paul, come back, come back.
No, I'm not going to talk.
Come back, Paul, come back.
Do it.
Come back.
Do
you
it.
Just want me to talk about
it? Yeah, you got it.
I'm sorry, Paul. I'm sorry you weren't there. You decided to go to New York. Were invited.
It's great.
You were invited. All right.
Enjoy, everybody.
Okay, all right. Okay, this was live from Comic-Con. Every year I try to go down to Comic-Con and do an episode down there. Usually I'm down there for business and pleasure reasons. And a lot of people are down there as well. And this time we had a great group. We have Lauren.
Sounds great.
We have Lauren Lapkus, Jason Mantzoukas, John Gabris, our good old intern Gino, and of course Thomas Middleditch happened to be down there as well. Great. And this sort of acts as a de facto sequel to the Kid Detectives saga.
Thank God.
Because Thomas and Lauren decided to do the Kid Detectives together.
The best.
If you're gonna talk on mic.
Oh, I didn't realize I was talking.
You realized you were sarcastically talking, didn't
what?
You?
What?
Feel free to chime in. Just do it on mic.
You got it.
Now, listeners will be interested to know that we had a couple of celebs in the audience watching this. We had from the TV show Orphan Black, we had Tatiana Maslany, and we also had Christian Brune. They were in the audience. They happened to be there for Orphan Black, and when they heard the lineup, they said, "We got to get over there." And they came out and watched this episode. So imagine that while you're listening to it.
Hope they had fun.
This is you've picked it as the number two. Did I say number three before? Because it is number two. This is
even better.
This is actually the number two episode of the live. Episodes. This is live from Comic-Con, your number two.
Number two.
Oh, so funny. Paul, I'm sorry you weren't there.
Yeah.
Are you ready to talk again?
Sure.
I'm sorry. You chose not to come?
Yep.
What's wrong? What's really wrong? What's really wrong?
Everybody liked it so much.
They liked it because it was funny. You thought it was funny. You were laughing harder than anyone while we were listening to it. You were rolling.
Oh, I was looking at something on my phone. Funny.
What were you looking at?
Funny video.
A funny video of what?
A baby and a dog.
What are they doing?
They're having a great time together, snuggling.
That doesn't sound funny. It sounds heartwarming.
It was funny and heartwarming.
Wait, I mean, you were laughing so hard.
That's how I laugh when my heart is warmed.
And can I say you were also laughing anytime anyone says anything funny during the clip?
It's just it synced up like Dark Side of the Moon and Pink Floyd.
I don't think so. I think Pink Floyd. Remember when Dark Side of the Moon and Pink Floyd synced up
perfectly
and made that record that was so popular? All right, we need to take a break. When we come back, we will have the number six episode of the year. This is exciting. We're getting all the way up. And this one, Paul, I think you're going to like a little bit more.
I hope so.
All right, we'll be right back with more Comedy Bang Bang. Oh, we are back. And boy, we are really getting into it here.
Yeah, man, we are.
We're going to crack the top five on this episode.
Like, Scott, I'm proud of us.
I'm proud of us, too.
We could have given up. How many times did we want to give up during this process?
How many times, by the way, and we've edited all of them out. But after every sentence, we've checked in and said, do you want to give up?
Yeah. And the response always is, I do, but, but we shouldn't.
We shouldn't. We need to keep going.
Yeah.
So let's keep doing that. By the way, do you want to give up?
I do, but we shouldn't.
We should keep going. Yeah. Okay. So we're going to keep going. Let's get to it. This is your episode number six.
Number six.
All right. This is episode number six. And let me give you a date that it occurred. This is September 19.
The Cuervo Gold.
Now, so let's see what? If you can guess what episode this is. Ooh. Okay. September, third week of September, what normally happens?
Do I remember
the very third week of September? What have we done the past couple of September? Or what happens every year in September? Think of showbiz.
The Showbiz Awards.
Definitely the Showbiz Awards in the field of television.
The Emmy Awards.
That's right, the Emmy Awards. Now, for the past couple of years, there's been a person nominated. There's been a person nominated, and everyone from the show
Scott,
comes
Scott, shut
up.
I know exactly what this
what
is.
What are you?
This is going to be an episode with our friend Tatiana Maslany, Kristen Brune, Mary Holland, and myself.
You nailed it. That's right. Episode 446 on September 19th, Scrounging and Lounging.
Scrounging and Lounging.
That's right. Now, both of those guys have, they film up in the Canada.
Look, they film up in the Canada.
You know, they're not down here all the time, although I do believe Christian is moving down here.
He should.
When the show wraps.
Yeah.
But they film up there in Canada. They're not here every week.
She should too.
You know what I mean? Most of show business here.
They listen to the show.
They do, yeah.
Tatiana.
Can we speak to you for 1 second? Especially, like, they're probably going to listen because their episode is now in the countdown.
Tatiana, could you see us in your kitchen for a second? Will you take this podcast into your kitchen? Tatiana.
Hey.
What are you doing? Of course you're going to move to L.A. What are you talking about?
What's happening right now?
You belong here.
You're living in Toronto the rest of your life? Come on.
It's great, but it's time. You got to leave. You got
to
leave.
You're always writing to me complaining that you don't get CISO up there.
Yeah.
And making me send you all the episodes to take my wife and bajillion. Just move down here where you can get CISO.
It's CISO all the time down here.
And I know CISO's been promising to be up there in Canada for at least one calendar year.
But listen, just between you and me.
They're lying.
They are liars.
The CISO are the biggest liars in show business.
They lie all the time.
Oh, it's disgusting. Tatiana,
you belong down here.
You belong here.
You're one of us.
You've heard that song. We love it. Century Boulevard. Yeah,
it's about Los Angeles.
We love it.
Did you not know that? What's about L.A.?
It's about L.A.
It's about L.A.
Do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do. We love it.
We love it.
Mm-hmm.
Listen.
We'd love it.
Oh,
you know what I'm saying? We'd love it.
Touchdown. Come
smoke
down
weed
here.
Every day.
Be an LA person. Get high
LA
with
person.
Us.
Come get high with us every day.
Scott and I, all we do is get high.
And then we record this show.
And then we record
we can't do the show without being high.
Listen, it's true. A lot of people say it and we deny it, but we get high.
We get high before every show.
Every show.
And we hope that you get high while you listen to it and before you listen to it.
This is what it could be like. Listen, I know what you're thinking. Oh, am I going to have to hang out with Christian all the time? No.
No.
It's a big sprawling city.
You'll never have to see him. Look, the minute that Donnie and Allison wrap their final scene, you never have to lay eyes on that motherfucker ever again.
Yeah. You don't have to go to the wrap party because you'll be busy working on another thing.
Yeah, you'll be. Look, they're not going to shift the wrap party around your schedule. No.
You're just the lead of the show.
You just leave the show and you're like
18 characters.
Uh-huh. You're like, check out the back of my ass, motherfuckers. Yeah. And you're just out the door.
That's right. And they have their little wrap party and they're like, oh, what are we going to do now? All our careers are over.
All of our careers are over. Meanwhile, yeah. Emmy winner over here, she gets to do whatever the fuck she wants.
Right. You should be down here.
You should be with the Emmy winners like myself.
Yeah. And Emmy nominees like me.
Sure. So look, if you're listening, can we count on you?
We know you are.
We know you are.
Come on.
You have nothing better to do.
Do the right thing.
Do the right thing.
For yourself. All right.
Okay. All right.
Let's get back to
the show. All right. Let's talk to Christian, too.
Yeah. Hey, Christian.
Hey, Christian.
Christian.
Do you mind not texting us so much?
Yeah. Could you listen?
You have that, what is it called? The Hardwick Mysteries? Stick to that.
You play Constable Johnstable or whatever his name is.
Constable Johnstable.
He's got a trumpet and he solves crimes somehow.
He's got a trumpet. He's got a trumpet, the fucking trumpet, Christian.
Listen,
what's your problem?
How about this? You could start, maybe stay in Canada.
Maybe you just stay there.
Bring that Nike swoosh show up there.
I know you got plans to come down here. We have enough actors.
Maybe ease into it. You don't want to jump into the deep end right away.
Put your toe into the water.
Yeah, come on.
You know what I mean?
Okay. All right. Good talk.
Good talk. Great. All right. We're going to hear this clip. Now, what's interesting, I don't know if this is in the clip itself, but anytime we have someone who is nominated for an Emmy and they tape the episode right before the ceremony, we like to joke about like, oh, what are you going to say when you win? And I'm not going to say that we didn't think Tatiana should win, because I have always said that she should win that award because of just the sheer amount of acting she does. It's not done by tonnage, but it's, you know, I mean, she acts way more than any other nominee, male or female.
She literally does. I mean, it's a singular feat. It's a really amazing thing that she did.
But the Emmys are not really ever fair or just. So in my mind, I was thinking there's no way that, so we were sort of joking around.
Your win in that.
Yeah, exactly. No, there are a lot of people who would say it is definitely not just. And by the way, wins. So we were joking around about what her speech would be when she won.
And well, even that we were joking about where her speech was because it was coming out the day after the awards.
Supposedly she would win.
Yeah.
And motherfucker, if she didn't win that award, I was on my feet cheering. Mm-hmm. Also, there were not enough chairs at the party I was at.
So you were already on your feet.
I was already on my feet, yeah. Right. But I was cheering, and what a great moment, and she deserved it. And I think the only time we will have had a person who just won an Emmy and is on the very next episode of Comedy Bang Bang, because normally if you are nominated, when you come out here, especially from another city, you're in the middle of a whirlwind press tour.
Yes.
And you have to do so much while you're here that the fact that those two guys make time to do the show.
Make it a priority.
Like, and made it a priority is fantastic. So let's listen to this. And by the way, I also want to set up in this episode, Mary Holland has probably the best entrance of any Comedy Bang Bang episode ever.
It destroyed me like nothing has in a really long time.
She plays Janice Cramps. We're going to hear that entrance. So this is your episode number 6.
Number 6.
Oh, so good. So right.
So just.
So just. All right. I got to tell you, we're only halfway through this episode.
What? That can't be true.
Let's take a break. When we come back, we are going to hear number 5 and then number 4 in the countdown. Very exciting. We'll be right back with more Comedy Bang Bang. Comedy Bang Bang.
We're back.
Comedy Bang Bang.
Power wheels.
Power wheels. Welcome back. Paul F. Tompkins here. Hi. And we're cracking the top 5 now.
I'm Paul F. Tompkins. It's just, I feel like if someone downloaded this, they fast-forwarded to this point, you say Paul F. Tompkins here, they think you're like broadcaster
they would
style.
They would misunderstand. I was saying Paul F. Tompkins here and referring
that's
to
me.
You
I'm
located here. But I am not Paul F. Tompkins, certainly, nor would I ever pretend to be.
Scott Aukerman here.
Look, there are certain situations where maybe I would pretend to be Paul F. Tompkins. Let's say you called me up and you were like, Scott, I can't get home and Janie is expecting me to make love to her.
Of course. God.
Would you mind? We keep it very dark in the house.
Yes. it's pitch black in there.
Slipping into the side door?
It's like a cave, yeah. Yeah, just slip in the side door.
Go under the covers.
Yeah.
Do what you need to do.
Do what you need to do.
Do what I need you to do. And that would be one of the only reasons to pretend to be you.
See, I feel like you get off on talking about this shit.
Yeah, well, at least I don't get off on doing it.
What? Are you accusing me of liking having sex with my wife?
Yes. You dirty pig.
Dirty pig.
All right, let's crack the top 5. This is your number 5.
Number 5.
Okay, this is
okay.
Okay. This is an episode from June 20th. So who knows what's going on? This is episode 429.
620.
An episode called Almost Mandatory.
Mm-hmm.
And these are two people named Jason Mantzoukas, been on the show many times.
Many times.
And of course, Thomas Middleditch. This is now his third appearance on the countdown.
Great.
Why are you upset at Thomas Middleditch?
You know, it just seems like there was a time when people really enjoyed my work on the show, and now
let's count how many times you've been on the countdown. You literally
this year?
The one we just played was you. The historic rap.
Great.
That's classic. Number one. Montreal.
Perfect.
Number two. Love is Thicker Than Water.
So,
number three.
So good.
Time Bobby Four. Mm-hmm. Number four.
A great one.
Sydney. Number five.
Right. Well, the tour ones don't count because I guess they do because there was one that I wasn't on and I made it into the best.
Scrounging and Lounging 6. You've been on the countdown 6 times so far.
Why not 7?
Well, maybe you will be.
Oh, you think?
I think you might be. All right. This is Almost Mandatory. And this was, Jason Mantzoukas and Thomas Middleditch. And Middleditch, who we all know from Silicon Valley. He is the titular Silicon. He is playing improvising a character named Edmund Carlyle, a British fellow, and this is all improvised, obviously, and never been on the show before, and this is just all off the top of the head.
Wait, what? The character had never been on the show before.
Never been on the show before, nor since, and this is all just something new. So for those of you who say, don't do so many sequels, don't do... you know, all this stuff that you've always done, this is all brand new.
There you go. So why don't you take this and choke on it?
Bitch. Seriously. Bitch, Ben.
Choke on it, bitch. Little Jesse Pinkman for you. Choke on it, bitch. Listen.
God
damn. Mr. White. Mr. White. Choke on it, bitch.
I felt I had a better grasp on it.
Why wasn't I in the countdown more? No, this guy lost it, too.
It's
very elusive.
Yeah.
The Jesse Pinkman, very elusive.
Speaking of the elusive Mr. Pinkman, let's hear him not be in this episode. This is your number five.
Number five.
All right, number five.
How about it?
How about it?
Good episode. Wasn't on the show before. Now he's on it. Never will be again.
Who knows? Maybe he will. Who knows? 2017 may be the year of Edmund Carlyle. Who knows? All right. We need to take a break. When we come back, we will crack the top four. That's right. Your episode number four when we come back with Comedy Bang Bang. Comedy Bang Bang. Paul F. Tompkins is here. Across from me. And
I like you.
Boy, this is exciting. The number four episode of the year. Are you excited?
Getting down there, man. And
we should say this is number four.
Number four.
That's right, number four. Coming up.
We're in the home stretch.
We literally are. I mean, we'll really be in the home stretch on our next episode.
Is it stretch or stredge?
You've thought it was home stretch?
I thought it was more in the home stretch.
There's a band that sings We Are Family. Who do you think they are?
Sly and the Family Stedge?
Sister Stedge?
Oh, Sister Stedge.
Damn, if you had known who sang that, would have been good.
I forgot. Why did I think it was Sly and the Family Stone?
Look, the difference between Sly and the Family Stone and Sister Sledge is so razor thin.
Oh.
You know what I mean?
Daylight wouldn't pass between them.
All right, this is your episode number four. This is from May 2.
Mm.
And you know what happens at the end of April, beginning of May?
We go on tour.
We did.
Yeah, right?
But before we did, we recorded this episode. This is the 7th anniversary episode.
Oh, my stars and garters.
Mm-hmm.
As Hank McCoy, the Beast, would say in comic books.
You were on this episode, so are you happy now?
Yeah. That's all it takes, Scott. Not really that hard to figure out.
Jason Mantzoukas, he's been all over this.
Yeah, I don't like that.
Yeah, I don't like that at all.
I don't like that.
Horatio Sanz, that's great.
Sure, okay.
Neil Campbell, this is his first appearance on the top 10.
He's a funny guy, should be on more.
And he's in number four. And we have Mike Hanford and Tim Baltz.
Very funny.
And Drew Tarver, both of those guys from Bajillion cast members.
Bajillion friends, very funny.
That's right.
Work friends.
Work friends. And this is, of course, we have Mike Hanford's playing John Lennon. Neil Campbell's playing the timekeeper. You do your Tom Lennon on the phone impression. Horatio's playing Shelley Driftwood, who is who even knows how to describe him.
Somewhat amorphous character.
But I enjoy him.
Absolutely.
Gives a lot of directions.
That's right. That's his one.
That's his one thing.
His one specific thing.
A lot of directions.
Yes. Yeah, yeah.
Let's hear it. This is your number four.
Number four.
All right, number four. A good number.
It is a good number.
A worthy number.
It's in the top five numbers.
It definitely
is.
In
my opinion.
Let's count them down.
Number five.
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 Number four. Four.
Number three. Two.
Two.
Number one. Three.
We forgot number two, which would be number one. We got confused during that bit.
A problem.
All right, we need to wrap it up. We talked about Mr. Microphone. That was my one goal for this episode.
Yes.
Peaked early. What's going on with Steph Curry? What's going on with the game that you're watching? Anything happening?
No.
What do you mean? It's not happening anymore? They called it off due to rain?
What, are they still making fun of his shoes?
They're still playing it, but I'm not trying to watch it.
Watch it. Do it. Look, we've been here for the entire day. I'm not even saying don't watch it, Cody. I'm saying don't turn it on in the middle. Don't turn the sound on in the middle of a recording. That's
just
all.
Like, you know, first thing, check the sound level. See, like, is this going to make noise if I turn this on?
That's
and
all.
Turn it on.
It was like a Russian stream or something. So
I
didn't know.
No more.
Is Steph Curry playing in Russia right now?
Wait, do you think he's behind the DNC hacks?
Oh, my God.
Steph Curry's our man?
Influencing our elections via Russia.
All right.
He's mad because everyone made fun of his shoes.
We got to end it there. We'll be back on Thursday with our top three episodes and our number one live episode and perhaps something else.
Oh, perhaps.
Bonus! That's right. So we'll be back on Thursday. We'll see you then. Thanks. Bye. Don't tell me to get my shit together. What do you take me for, a dung beetle? Welcome to Comedy Bang Bang.
Who was that?
That was Elvis Cholesterol Stello. Elvis Cholesterol Stello. I may have just wanted to say Elvis Cholesterol Stello. I don't know that I like the catchphrase.
How does it feel now that you said it?
Not good. I kind of lost my way in the middle of it. But hey, brought it all back at the end.
You sure did.
I sure did, yes. Welcome to the show, Comedy Bang Bang 4. This is our fourth of four best of episodes, a yearly tradition that I would not do without. And
not do without.
No, I would not do without.
Would not? Could not?
If we didn't do these episodes, I would not do these episodes.
I feel much the same.
Scott Aukerman here, and we're coming up on New Year's Eve in a few days, so that's exciting.
A new year. Maybe this year will be different. Maybe
different
it'll
than what?
Be different than last year was, this past year.
Maybe. Probably be worse.
Probably.
Who knows? Look, there's a lot of joy to be had in life, and we hope that we're a part of that. If you enjoy the show, it's right there in the title. Enjoy? Joy.
Wait, what?
Joy is right there in enjoy.
Oh, you consider words titles.
Yeah, exactly. When they had to come up with a title for that feeling, it's a title. Yeah, it's a word.
That's the title.
This is sound logic.
You know what I'm saying.
I do know what you're saying.
Language is all about communication, so if you know what I'm saying, then I've done my job.
Now, Laurie Anderson famously talks saying that language is a virus
from
Superman? Outer space. Yes, the same.
Okay.
She said language is a virus from outer space. Do you think that's true?
A virus from outer space.
Yeah.
You know, it is. I do have to say, it's a little weird that there's so many different languages.
Right?
You know what I mean?
It's impractical.
It really is, because you go to these different countries, and it's so easy to get to countries now. You just, like, hop on a little puddle jumper.
You hop on your private plane. You go right over there.
Right. And then you get off the plane, and suddenly everyone's speaking a different language. It's like, whoa, slow your roll.
Stay in your lane.
But if you could only speak one language, which one would it be? Because I'm not convinced it's English. English is not the most pleasant sounding language.
This is the thing. I think we need to vote on what the prettiest language is.
Some would say the romance languages are pretty, but at the same time, do they have enough in them? And this is really a question for linguists and cunning linguists.
I think I get what you're doing.
Yeah. But are the romance languages like Italian and Spanish, are there enough words in them to be poetic?
Because English has so many words.
So many words.
We took words from other languages.
Oh, yeah. And we just adapt them. So there's so many different ways to say things. Now, I would say the people who speak English don't use a lot of them, mm-hmm. including myself, and I don't even know how to pronounce half of them.
No, you're terrible.
Yes.
And I think that you have a learning disability.
I'm definitely not learning anything new.
I say we go back to basics and we do Greek or Latin.
Greek or Latin, you think so?
Everybody speaks, yes.
But what about Chinese?
Too hard.
It's hard, but is it not rewarding?
And it's not fair. Just because the majority of people are Chinese right now, then we're supposed to all do that.
But look, I'm not saying that we all have to learn it. I'm saying that this is an alternate universe where just click, everyone speaks it. What is the most pleasurable to speak? Is it Chinese? I don't know
that's the most pleasurable
to speak. It's not the most pleasurable to listen to. I don't know. But maybe they love it. When you understand it, maybe it's like, oh my God, how beautiful that sounds. So they would say the romance languages would be because they're so, buongiorno, you know, they're just so wonderful to listen to.
Italian, I think, is an easy language to speak and also sounds very nice.
It sounds very, fine line.
Porky
pig. That's
I'm
all,
Italian,
folks. Love it.
That's what it was before World War II.
And then they had to change it. Yeah, we hate them now.
Yeah.
Boy, how things change. The more things change, the more things stay the same. Am I right?
What does that mean?
I hate Italians.
You like Italian food, though.
Oh, love it. Oh, my favorite type of food. If it weren't Italians making it.
But you have American people make your Italian food.
Yes, of course. The most authentic Italian food. Paul?
Yeah.
New Year's Eve coming up and 2017 right around the corner. You just wrapped bajillion-dollar properties.
We sure did. We had a great time.
And new seasons of that coming out next year. That's exciting,
right? That's right. We had a ball. We had great guest stars. The mm-hmm. core cast is fantastic. I got to do more stuff on location this time than I did the last two seasons.
The last few seasons, you were in the office primarily.
Yes.
Mainly due to scheduling but we had a limited amount of time.
And also the storylines, too, just kind of made sense. And then I got to go out in the world with everybody, mm-hmm. which was a lot of fun.
So you got to drive to Malibu.
Got to drive to Malibu for a really long time.
Yep. So was it worth it?
Well, that's what it's going to decide. It was worth it. I'll say that.
Okay. I believe you.
It was a blast.
Oh, I can't wait to see him. I know I
have you seen any of it yet?
I haven't seen it. Next week, I will see my first couple of episodes, so I'm very excited by it. Yes.
Were you going to direct at one point?
I was, and then my top secret project, which I believe has been announced already at this point— not of the time of the recording, but at the time of the release, I believe my top secret project that I co-directed then took up all my time, so I could not direct.
Right. But this really was Mike Pence between two ferns.
Mike Pence. I think it's Pence every time I hear it. Like, he's so ridiculous. What if his name was just Mike Pence? And we were supposed to call him... He's a guy who had a name of Pants.
Mike Pants.
He's like, hi, I'm Mike Pants. And we were just like, okay, let's make you vice president.
I think that life is sacred. My name is Mike Pants.
That's your in into impersonating him?
If a woman gets punched in the stomach, she ought to have a funeral for a baby she might have had.
Oh boy, getting political.
I know. You know what though? We never talk about this stuff.
We never talk about it.
But this, it was very hard not to think about it all the time this year.
Yeah. Well, you know, so poor us. Snowflake.
Boo hoo. I'm in my safe space with my trigger warnings.
Look, what we're doing is we're counting down on this episode the top 3 Comedy Bang Bang episodes of the year. Now,
top 3 like you, me, Pepe the Frog. My personal top 3.
Oh, jeez. We also have our top 1 live episode of the year.
Yes.
So this is the big stuff. This is the good stuff. I hope you are, Paul. I hope you are. Now, you all voted on your favorite episodes of the year, and these are the big ones. These are the this is the good stuff. Go this on. Is what you wanted to hear. So
the big ones.
What are you? You're waggling your eyebrows up and down at a speed which I have not.
Big ones.
Hmm? What are you trying to say to me right now?
Am I doing a sex thing?
Yes, you're talking about penis size.
Am I?
Yeah.
I don't know what
you're talking about
are.
Multiple big penises right now.
I don't know what things are.
You don't know what penises are?
Any things.
Can you look down? I think you have one.
Look at all this money I dropped.
And that cat.
Callbacks.
Guys, what do you say? Do you want to get to it?
What do you say, guys? Let's give them a second.
Votes are in.
Someone said Satan is king.
What?
Did you hear that?
I did not hear that. Someone said Satan is
king.
You
didn't hear very clearly in your headphones someone saying Satan is king.
I think that is just something that you're maybe hearing that doesn't exist.
I can't imagine
that's true. Can I ask you a question? Yeah. Are you a paranoid schizophrenic?
I mean, define paranoid schizophrenic.
Oh, okay, sure. A person who has something wrong in their brain where they see and hear things that are not existing in the real world?
Okay, by that definition, I guess so.
Yeah, that's very specific, so yes, you are.
Okay,
one.
So, okay, now.
You're hearing things. You are hearing Satan's voice commanding you.
What is, I know we got to get to the countdown, but what is real?
Well, not sure that you are.
Because, I might be imaginary.
Because I might be a paranoid schizophrenic.
Are you fucking kidding me that I'm imaginary and I'm a paranoid schizophrenic?
Yeah.
This is bullshit.
That's what I've imagined. It's a lot.
Stop imagining that.
It's a Westworld situation where I need you to have flaws in order to make you more real.
When do I get to wear pants?
I'm
instead
sorry.
Of this dress.
I'm sorry, but never.
This is very practical.
I love you in the dress.
I love me in pants.
Let's just compromise at short shorts. What do you say?
How short are the shorts? Like up to my waist?
Yeah, no, yeah, they're like hat style. Call back to John Lennon.
Call back to another thing.
All right, let's get to it. Let's do the top three. This is your number three.
I like Westworld, by the way.
Number three.
All right, this is number three. And, Paul, we've been talking about how early some of these episodes are from.
Scott, I've noticed it's a recurring theme in this countdown
this year. This is from December 14th of last year.
Is this the earliest one?
No, December 7th, was the earliest one. Day.
Never forget.
Yes, never forget. But this is 1 week after that one. This is episode 391, Holiday Spectacular 2015.
These shows are always nuts.
Mm-hmm. We just had one two weeks ago.
That's right.
That was even more nuts than normal because almost everyone that I asked to do it said yes.
That's right. I think maybe one person didn't show up, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Normally what happens on the holiday ones and the
anniversaries
is I'll put out a big email to a lot of people who are our favorite guests of the year.
Calling all cars.
And I say, hey, who can show up? And normally one third of the people can show up. On the one this year, not the one that we're going to hear the clip from, but the one this year, everyone said they could, and one person did not. Mm-hmm. So we had 15 guests, I believe.
It was crazy. Yeah.
It was pretty crazy. Anyway, but they're some of my favorite episodes of the year. They're just anything goes, and this one is no exception. This has you, Paul.
Hi.
Lauren Lapkus.
Sure.
John Gabris. Mm-hmm. Mike Hanford. Neil Campbell. And Will Hines.
I mean, that to me sounds good.
It sounds good to me.
That sounds good to me.
Now, obviously, let's address this. Obviously,
let's get it out of the way.
A lot of dudes, one woman.
I had no idea what you were going to say.
But that's what happens on these large episodes is I put it out to a large group of people, and it's whoever can show up at that specific time. So, look, the invites are going out. That's all I can say.
I think that's a good thing to point out about booking. If you don't know how these things work, no one gets paid for doing podcasts.
Yes. And it's not like we're sitting there and everyone comes up to us and says, we're always available. Put us in your show.
Right.
And we can pick from anyone in the world.
Yes. Yeah. It's hard because a lot of times I go through the same thing where I certainly have an idea of who I would like to get for the show for any given episode, but you don't always get the person that is your first choice for that particular – like because I think that your show and my show work in similar ways where you make these configurations
of
people.
You're trying to get a good group that will work together.
Exactly. Yes, so you have in your mind, oh, I'd love to get these people together at the same time, but it's very hard to coordinate everybody's schedules. And also, you're dealing with people that are good people who are in demand, and yes. it's hard to get people sometimes.
The fact that anyone makes time for the show is very touching to me. So I appreciate anyone who can show up. So in any case, this is a great episode, one of my favorites. I remember we did it, and we were all like, hey, that was really, really good. Mm-hmm. And this is the first time that John Gabris got to play intern Gino on one of these big episodes.
Oh, really?
He cracked the top three. This is, I don't believe he was represented on the countdown at all last year. And
I kind of remember that, yeah.
We did a tribute to him and did a little best of some of his clips, and now he's been in the San Diego show and mm-hmm. also...
San Diego show.
and also this show, and more power to him, or white power to him is what I mean. Are we switching that yet?
I don't think it's official yet. I think it's like late in January.
But okay, so who do we got? We got intern Gino, and then we have Mike Hanford's playing John Lennon, mm-hmm. and a lot of strange stuff. And then we have Lauren Lapkus is playing Ho-Ho the Elf. And I'm sorry that Lauren could not come back and play Ho-Ho at the end of the year this year, but she is in England for the next few months. And which is unfortunate. I'd love to hear from Ho-Ho, but we didn't this year.
When we were doing the holiday episode, I did look at my phone to see what time it was.
To see if we could call in?
Yeah, I almost...
It was a little,
It was like 10 of 9, and I thought, well, she's probably...
10 of 9.
I don't know what that is. 10 of 9. And I thought, she's probably not...
Yeah,
probably
not doing something. Doesn't want to do a podcast.
Yeah.
Also, we have Santa, of course. Sure. Paul F. Tompkins playing Santa. We have Neil Campbell as the timekeeper. maybe you don't play Santa. I don't know, because you're also playing Andrew Lloyd Webber.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Maybe you went back and forth. I don't know. We'll hear
it. I probably did.
Yeah. Okay. So, anyway, let's hear a big compendium of clips from – this is an extra long episode. We're going to hear a lot of different clips from it. This is your number three.
Number three.
So good.
I wasn't looking, and I thought maybe that was another video that Cody was playing.
So good. We should play a game of we should turn around and we'll say, is it the other person or is it a Cody video? All right, Cody, do you have a video lined up? Okay, I'm going to turn around.
A video that could conceivably be one of us just in this room.
Right.
Okay.
All right, I'm going to turn around, and you guys decide amongst yourselves. I'm going to take the microphone, but I'm turned around. You guys decide amongst yourself whether it's going to be you, Paul, or a video.
Okay.
So it's our first, is it Paul or is it a Cody video?
Month. Breeding lilacs out of the dead land, mixing memory and desire, stirring dull roots with spring rain.
Okay, turn around.
Okay, turning around. Now, let me think. Now, you normally have a crackly kind of a lot of room tone, crackly,
I have a
poorly
lot of,
recorded yeah, room tone.
I have a lot of butterscotch wrappers in my pockets.
Right. That's got to be you, Paul.
It was a video.
It was a video? Oh.
What was that video, Cody?
That was T.S. Eliot reading The Wasteland.
Sure. Oh, interesting. Yeah, hey, getting a little education.
He crushed it, by the way.
Fucking T.S.
Fucking T.S.
You crushed that, bro.
Yo, did you see T.S. Eliot read The Wasteland? He fucking crushed it.
T.S., you're my boy, man. You fucking crushed that. Just call me Tss. You don't like it?
What's that? Why did that bother me?
Well, because people call you Pfft.
That's true. Some people do.
And that bothers you, I believe.
No, it's like the only thing that bothers me about it is mm-hmm. that people think that they invented it.
Right.
And
they say it like, hey, it's something I just thought of.
No one's ever said this before.
To be fair.
Everyone said it before.
To be fair.
TBF.
They did invent it. They just don't know other people have invented it.
It's sort of like,
they're not joke thieves.
They're not joke thieves. They're not the fat Jew. But
by the way, Fat Jew, what's next?
By the way, Fat Jew, what's next?
Fat Jew, what's next?
Ba-da-ba-ba-ba. By the way, Fat Jew, what's next? That is a great hook. They're just waiting for
a
bunch of song to be written around.
Someone, please take it. Do what you will with it.
By the way,
Fat Jew, what's next?
Fat Jew, what's next? It's good. It's good.
So good. So right. Hey, we got to take a break. We just heard our number three, so let's take a break. When we come back, we're going to have, we're probably going to count down, right?
I bet we will.
No, we won't. We'll be right back.
You set me up.
Comedy Bang Bang, we're back here, and Paul F. Tompkins, and yeah, that's right. You thought we were going to count down and air another clip that's part of our countdown, right?
I did. I totally did.
Because
you know what, though? You led me to believe that we were going
to
do
did.
That.
I led you down that primrose path.
Ugh.
Instead, we're going to do a little something that I like to call, and we haven't done one yet on the countdown, a little something called a bonus clip. That's right. We are going to play a little bonus clip. Now, in the past, we've played bonus clips because there have been little chunks of episodes that, whereas maybe the episode as a whole was not countdown worthy, but there's something that happened in
like
the episode.
It was like one good moment.
Yeah.
No. Or we've played bonus clips to save a life.
Sure. and this is one of those. This did not end up making the countdown, this particular episode, but when we released the episodes for the countdown, this particular clip is something that a lot of people were talking about, voting for. And this is from an episode from April 28th. This is episode 418 called Paul Reiser and the Apple Tree. So, Brendan Small, great comedian. He created Home Movies and Metalocalypse and a virtuoso on not only the guitar, but also his voice. He can do a lot of characters.
True.
He does Victor and Tiny. And also,
now it can be told.
And also Willie. These three characters. And he plays all three characters at the same time. Mm-hmm. Not at the same time. He goes back and forth from them at the same time.
Yes.
In the same recording. And anytime I ask him to do the show, and I ask him, you know, once every month, once every 2 months, something like that, you never know what you're going to get with him. Sometimes he'll show up and
he'll be a total asshole. He'll be like 4 hours late, drunk.
No, always a professional, always super nice.
Oh.
But what I mean to say is sometimes he'll come and he'll just kind of riff in the character voices. And every once in a while, he'll bring something that he has made at home and has just been waiting to debut. And this time, he did that. A previous time, he had edited together a podcast that they had recorded.
Oh, my God.
Some big laughs. And this is another big laugh one. This is he is debuting a song that Victor is singing. And so we're going to play this clip. It's really funny, a really funny clip. This is an episode that you are not going to forget. This is Brendan Small from Paul Reiser and the Apple Tree.
Bonus!
Yeah.
Yeah.
Great. Great stuff.
Great.
Do you remember where you were when you first heard the Apple Tree song?
Yeah, I was right here.
Oh, right. Wait, you were here?
Yeah.
You were listening to it?
No, just listened to the clip just now.
Oh, wait. You hadn't heard it before?
I don't listen to this shit.
You don't listen to this every week?
The fuck? Are you kidding me?
What are we doing this for?
I got better shit to do, man.
What do you have to do?
Kiss girls.
You're kissing a lot of girls?
Yeah, man. Oh. I'm out there kissing girls all the time.
Oh, man. I wish I was you. You're so cool.
I'm a pretty cool guy.
Oh, well, thanks to Brendan. That is, it didn't quite make the top 15, but super funny stuff. So let's take a break. When we come back, we're going to have the top two episodes of the year and also our number one live episode of the year. It is coming down to it, guys. We are getting through it. When we come back, we will do that. More Comedy Bang Bang after this. All right, Comedy Bang Bang, we're back here. Paul F. Tompkins is here, and this is suspenseful, isn't it? Every year at this time of year, it just gets to be like, oh, God, I can't wait to see what it is.
My chest is constricting. My breath is short.
Hold on a second. Wait, is
my
your
left
arm
is tingling?
Oh, no. I think you're having a heart attack.
I love this time of year.
Okay. Do you think you can finish the episode before we need to take you to the emergency room?
Oh, let me eat that bread that you're toasting first.
Oh, no. Oh, what? No. Okay. We got to rush through this. All right. Let's get to it. This is
time for the shitstorm.
Your episode number two.
Number two.
That's right. The second most popular episode of the year. This is from April.
Mm.
This is from a couple of weeks before that, or just 10 days before that last episode, the Paul Reiser and the Apple Tree. This is from April 18th.
Before that episode, April 18th. Okay. Okay. Mm-hmm. I think I have all the clues I need.
Mm-hmm. This is an episode called What Comes Out in April on HBO, the home box office.
That Bill Simmons show that got canceled?
No. Every year, I mean. Not something that got canceled.
Any given April?
It came in April. Game of Thrones does.
Okay.
Okay. But what comes on after Game of Thrones? You don't know, do you? Silicon Valley comes out.
Oh, sure.
That's right. This is an episode called Silicon Valley Poo Crew. So for the second year in a row, Thomas Middleditch and Martin Starr and Kumail Nanjiani all got together to celebrate the premiere
themselves. Yeah.
No, more like I asked them to do the show a favor and they do it in order to promote their show. But we have a really good time on both of these episodes. The first time I believe Middleditch ever did the show was on the previous one of the previous year. Mm-hmm. And these are really funny. Basically, Martin and Kumail and myself just play ourselves, and then Thomas improvises an insane character.
Right.
And
At least one.
And this one is a classic. This is Turd Dunkweed. Turd Dunkweed, a stand-up comedian. We're going to hear a little bit about his life, and this is a lot of fun. This is a great character. Let's hear it. This is your number two.
Number two.
Oh, Turd.
Turd.
Turd Dunkweed. All right. What do you think of that?
I think those guys are having a great time.
And you wished you were a part of it.
I don't. Of course I do. Of course I do.
Mm-hmm. You wished you were there.
The first one, a classic Jarl stopped by.
That's right. Yes. You know? So you were represented on that one.
I was represented on that one.
Mm-hmm.
Established in the classic Jarl's lore was that he's number 12 on the Silicon Valley call sheet.
Yeah, very weirdly. What is going on with classic Jarl? He has not been by lately.
No, I guess, his schedule just didn't sync up.
Classic Charles, of course, is someone that if you are recording your own show in the other studio,
that's right,
and you find out that Comedy Bang Bang is recording, you will burst in,
yes,
and do this character, which is only done for this purpose.
He is solely an interrupting character.
Mm-hmm.
And
mainly because his voice is very difficult to do.
It's very difficult.
He has a collapsed lung?
No.
No?
He's
a fencing instructor. I know that.
He's a fencing instructor. He's very patriotic and very religious. And the opening to his throat is too small. And it's very difficult for him to push words out.
Right, right, right.
He also has very soft teeth, which makes it difficult for him to eat a lot of food.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
And also his tiny windpipe makes it very difficult.
He's on very briefly, and yet we know so much about him.
Yeah. It's a little more every time.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I'd love to hear from him again.
My favorite thing about doing Jarls is that I will often be walking in on a room full of people I don't know.
Yes.
Like I'll know maybe one or two
people.
And
they will not know you and wonder what you're doing.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it's it's exciting. It's a real high wire act.
Oh, it is. It's a lot like that. What was that movie where Joseph Gordon-Levitt from
Third Rock from the Sun?
Yeah. Go.
You're thinking of the movie based on the documentary Man on Wire.
Right.
And the movie version of it was called Wire Man.
Other guy on different wire.
That's right. 50-50 chance of falling down to the ground.
All right. We need to take a break. When we come back, we're going to have two number ones, your number one live episode and your number one regular episode of the year. Getting exciting.
Shit,
motherfucker.
This is nuts.
Here we go. Let's take a break. We'll be right back with Comedy Bang Bang. Comedy Bang Bang, Paul F. Tompkins.
Hi.
Is here with me, and this is exciting. We're going to do our number one live episode of the year of the tour. This is exciting.
I'm very curious to see what people
choose. Let's hear it. This is your number one.
Number one.
All right, you're curious as to what you think people voted the best live episode of the year is.
I don't know.
What is your
favorite? As to what I think people voted. I'm curious as to what people voted.
Wait, you're not curious about what you think. I would be if I were you.
I wish I could compartmentalize my thoughts so well that I'm like, I wonder what I think about this.
Let me open up that secret room.
I'm curious to find out. Oh, my memory palace.
What is your favorite episode of the ones that we did? If you had to
pick. My favorite episode of the tour.
Yeah. Favorite stop.
Was Atlanta. That was my favorite episode of the whole tour.
Why is that?
I did a new character.
You did the contraptionaire.
I did the contraptionaire. It was exciting to do a new character. And
Lauren did Ho-Ho.
Lauren did Ho-Ho.
An old favorite.
That crowd was amazing. Drew Tarver was there with mm-hmm. us. He mm-hmm. did Donnie Gary, which I'd never seen before, mm-hmm. and just delighted me to no end. Mm-hmm. We had a nice dinner that night.
Nice dinner, and the venue was exciting to be in.
The venue was
the Tabernacle
so great,
in Atlanta.
So great. They treated us really well. Drew's family was there.
Drew's family was there and got to see him destroy in front of a crowd.
Destroy! He killed.
Happened twice to us. Neil Campbell, when his parents were there, gave one of the best shows of his.
Three times.
Oh, that's right, because your family was there in Philadelphia, and you did which...
It doesn't matter.
Sorry, I guess it's can't not remember memorable. Every it's family that comes...
So. No, it's okay. You just couldn't remember.
Look.
There was three, and you can remember.
Look, let's be honest. I'm thinking of us as like old guard where something like that.
For the kids.
It's for the kids. That's what I'm thinking of.
I get you. We're established geniuses.
So let's reveal what the number one episode is. May 11th.
Never forget.
Never forget. Atlanta. The listeners voted for our favorite tour
I was
episode.
Curious to see what I would think about it, and now my curiosity is satisfied.
Because you know what you thought about
it. I like it.
That's right. This is the Atlanta tour stop. Just everything was just working really well. Yeah. The contraptionaire and I talked for a good long time, and then Ho-Ho came out and was very funny, and then Donnie Gary came out. And
it was a very Georgia-themed episode.
It was.
Because the contraptionaire is a Georgia character from Savannah, Georgia. You were born in Savannah, Georgia, mm-hmm. and Drew is from Georgia.
That's right, and he was visiting his family there. So,
and we were in Georgia.
That's the final piece of the puzzle. So we're going to hear Ho-Ho. Ho-Ho came out first, and then the contraptionaire comes out, and then we are going to hear Donnie Gary comes out. So enjoy this. This is the top number one episode, live episode of the year. This is your number one.
Good work, everybody.
Number one.
Oh, I love hearing it again like I was there yesterday. Good stuff. I wish we could do a top 15 of the live episodes. That would be fun.
I wish so too.
But we could only do four.
Why? Who made that rule?
Me. You. good shit though, huh? Fun tour.
Will we do a tour again ever?
I don't know. It's a lot of work and a lot of time, true. But very rewarding, I think, not only in terms of seeing the fans, but also an artistic, I think, achievement to do that many episodes.
It was very challenging in a great way.
Mm-hmm.
In a great way. I really enjoyed the pressure of having to come up with new stuff every show. Yeah. And I had a couple duds along the way where I was like, where I learned from that experience.
I did too, but I really did feel like it was a learning experience where every step along the way I was like, oh, I'm getting better at this part of it, or I'm getting better at this part of it. And it really was one of those things where I felt like the entire tour, and it wasn't like we started slow and ended strong. It was maybe mm-hmm. the reverse. No, it was no, but it was, you know, I mean, that first episode got a lot of votes, by the way, the live from the Ace Hotel.
That got was a good one.
That got a lot of votes, didn't crack the top four, but that was a great one. And then we just went on that tour. I mean, you know, it probably was a mistake for me to go from ending my TV show. The last day was the day before the Ace Hotel show, and then 2 days later on a plane.
That was dumb.
That was dumb.
Yeah.
Shouldn't have done that.
Live and learn.
Yeah, but I mean, we only had a small window that we could do it, and I said I would rather go immediately from the TV show into...
Also, I think the TV schedule had changed somewhat, too, that maybe those things were not going to be quite so close together.
Yeah, a lot. It just kind of happened that way, but I really enjoyed it. That said, I do not think that we're doing it next year.
Oh, I'm not for sure.
Yeah, and maybe some festival dates along the way, but not an actual tour. That said, I do believe that you should do a Spontaneous Nation tour.
We'll see. I feel like this past year was so much travel that I'm not in any hurry to.
You did not only did you do 39 Bang Bang dates, but you did a lot of Thrilling Adventure.
Yeah, there was a lot of stuff going on, and it was all fun. It was all fun, but I think you got to manage your time.
Yeah, exactly. So let's take a year off.
Let's reassess.
And then make
more things.
Yes, exactly. You know? And who knows? Maybe in 2018, no one will care about Comedy Bang Bang anymore, and we'll be like, I can't believe anyone ever came to a tour of that anyway.
I fully expect my career to be over in a matter of weeks.
Really? What's happening in a couple weeks?
I don't know. But I wouldn't be surprised.
All right, let's take a break. When we come back, this is exciting. The number one episode of the year. Mm. Boy, what could it be? What could it be?
I know what it is.
You do know what it is?
Yeah.
How did you know?
You want me to just say?
Yeah. Did you hack into my emails?
Yeah.
Ah, damn it.
Yeah.
All right. We'll be right back with more Comedy Bang
Bang. I'm Julian Assange.
Comedy Bang Bang. This is it. We're here with Paul F. Tompkins, and we're going to be balls deep in a second.
BD.
Wouldn't you?
In a sec.
BD in a hot sec.
Oh, we're so close.
We're so close to being balls deep.
Do you know
deep.
That song, Last Christmas, I Gave You My Heart?
Yeah, sure.
The very next day.
Well. You gave it away.
You gave it away?
Yeah. So, like, now he has to date?
Yeah. What is this weird arrangement?
He's been enslaved?
I guess we're dating now. What?
All right.
Yeah, I got your heart from this asshole.
Seems unfair. Oh, well. But hey, a gift is a gift.
What about threw it away? You know what I mean?
Yeah, George.
Come on, George.
One more pass. Although it doesn't sound as musical. I threw it. You threw it. It doesn't sound
you
as good.
Tossed it, you tossed it in the bin.
Terrible.
Terrible.
Terrible. All right, guys. This is it. This is it. We are at it. This is our number one.
I can't believe this.
Number one.
I can't believe it.
I can't believe it either. This is the number one episode of the year voted by you, the listening public. And we had a lot of great episodes this year. And I believe every once in a while, an episode will get a lot of votes because and I've talked about this on previous best ofs, it has a very easy to understand title that is representative of what the episode is. And people like the episode,
right?
But it's easier to vote for something when it has a simple title where you go, oh yeah, that episode,
I
love that one.
Remember exactly what it was.
Weirdly enough, mm-hmm. Almost mandatory. No way of even knowing what that episode is.
I've already forgotten what it is.
Yeah, it was Jason Mantzoukas and Thomas Middleditch,
there we go.
I believe. No idea what is in that episode or why it's called Almost Mandatory, and yet it got a lot of votes. So maybe my theory is for nothing. But this is an episode from March 7th. Episode 406. So, boy, right after 400, 401, 402. I mean, that stretch was a really good stretch. Mm-hmm. This is an episode called Kid Detectives 2.
Okay.
What is wrong?
That sounds funny.
You didn't make the number one episode this year.
That's cool. Hey, man, it's great.
You're the number one live episode.
Yeah, sure.
And
the paywall.
And you're the number three. You're on the number three.
Number three.
And you've been on this countdown now, what, 8 times?
You know, it's great.
I apologize.
No, right? No, nothing to apologize for. You don't have to apologize for anything.
We'll try harder next year.
I wish I could make more effort. I wish I could.
Yeah, but it's just physically impossible.
It's physically impossible.
Look, I have to say that so many of the live episodes would have beaten a bunch of the top 15 episodes, you think?
No doubt.
If all of them were just, if everyone heard all of them and it was just comparing.
Yeah, there'd be a parade for me.
I don't know about that, but I would say that a lot of those live episodes that we did would have cracked the top 10.
I know that there would have been a parade for me.
Okay. All right. So this is Kid Detectives 2. This is Lauren Lapkus and Thomas Middleditch.
Great.
And I got to say, one thing, to give a little shout out to Thomas Middleditch, he did 4 episodes this year. All he did were 4 episodes. 1 live and 3 in studio. His 3 in studio were voted on by all of you in the top 5. And his 1 live episode was in the top 3 of the live episodes.
So what are you trying to say? You're looking at me saying this.
I'm just saying that he was like an assassin. By the way, I have to look at you when I'm talking to you. We're not playing Paul or Cody video.
It was great, though, when we did.
It was really good.
That was a good round.
But what a record. I mean, that's like batting 1,000 in a way. You know what I mean?
Must be satisfying.
Stop this character. We're celebrating. We're celebrating these people.
Let's celebrate Thomas because I don't think he's been celebrated enough. This poor guy. Let's give him a break. Finally let this be a good thing in his life.
Come on. You and I have been Thomas Middleditch fans for a long time.
I loved him Improvised Shakespeare Company.
Improvised Shakespeare Company, we saw them many years ago. All those guys are great.
That's right.
So here's another fact. When I did Bonnaroo, the Bonnaroo Festival, we did a live sort of hybrid stand-up comedy bang bang and improvised comedy bang bang thing with James Adomian and Thomas Lennon and Reggie to celebrate the second season of the TV show. When I did Bonnaroo, all the improvised Shakespeare guys were there and, said hi to them. And, you know, I'd been seeing them at a few festivals and I was always saying, oh guys, I think you guys are so funny, but I did not know Thomas, really other than, hey, you're in this improvised Shakespeare festival. You probably don't know my work. Somehow in the Bonnaroo Festival, we had to leave at 4 a.m. to get to our plane. Okay. And so we all gathered in the hotel lobby. And I tell you, the after party was still going on in there.
Ugh. That made me so tired.
But it was 4 a.m. and our car does not come. The Bonnaroo person that they sent, the Bonnaroo intern, does not come. 4:30 doesn't come. At 4:30, I call the helpline that they give you. Guess what isn't working at 4 a.m?
The helpline?
The helpline in order to help you with your travel arrangements. Yeah. That's right.
Probably the person who mans the helpline was 2 feet away from you at the bar.
Probably. So no one's answering, and we're like, we are going to miss our plane. By the way, this is in the middle of Tennessee, I believe Bonnaroo is, right? And
I do not know.
Okay. And this is in the middle of nowhere, kind of, and not a place where cabs are. And to call a cab, we tried calling a cab, and they were like, we can get there in like 45 minutes.
Oh, my God.
So, and no one will answer the helpline. And lo and behold, we see Thomas come down the stairs. It's like 4:45 in the morning. He's going to the airport, not through a Bonnaroo, but HBO, because he's on Silicon Valley, has hired him a car in order to get him back to the set as soon as possible. And there are like 5 of us and we say, and I don't know him. And I'm like, Thomas, are you going to the airport? Do you think you could take all of us in your HBO car?
Right.
And he was like, of course. And we all jumped into the car. Super nice. We got to the airport in time and did not miss the flight. So that's a little Thomas story, but because I was reminded of the Improvised Shakespeare Festival, we're a big fan of his. If anyone
Improvised
deserves,
Shakespeare Company.
This is a company, yes.
Well, but it's like this group of guys that are really great at doing this thing. It's not like a big event where they are just to give them proper credit.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. It's like how many people are in it? 5 or?
I think like
there's a
in
rotating.
Total, I think it's like maybe 6 to 8 guys.
I've been on their website recently. Yeah, there's like a rotating group of people.
And they do 4 at a time when they do a show.
Right, right. Yeah. It's one of the greatest. I believe we've talked about it. If you're ever at a festival or where they're putting on a show, a great night. At the theater, and you'll laugh a lot. And I went in a little skeptical, kind of going, how good can this actually be?
Yeah.
Improvised Shakespeare. And not only do they nail the humor part of it, but they also do such specific things to Shakespeare.
It's incredible.
It's really incredible. So, you know, if anyone can be on a big popular HBO show, I'm glad that one of those guys is. So good on him. And what a record. This year, 4 episodes and all four of them in the top 5. This is Kid Detectives 2, the sequel to Kid.
I forgot we didn't even do the clip yet.
No, we haven't. This is the sequel to the Kid Detectives episode where Lauren and Thomas just improvise these young characters. And so let's hear it. This is a crazy episode. They are, of course, JJ and Murphy O'Malaman, and they are child detectives. That's all you need to say. Here we go. This is your number one of the year.
Number one.
Okay. Kid detectives too.
They did it.
They're insane.
They're insane people.
Lauren, love you. Wish you had such a great time with you this year. Wish you weren't in England. You know, we could be spending the holidays together.
Me, you know what? I miss Lauren, too. I miss her podcast on Fridays.
Yep. By the way, if you're a Comedy Bang Bang fan, the very last episode of With Special Guest with Lauren Lapkus
that's right.
was a lot of fun to do. You and I and Lauren yeah. all together in an insane episode that defies description, yeah. although many have tried.
And they have all failed. They're
all
failures.
Failed. They are.
They go home to their wives.
They're spineless worms.
Oh, and their wives know. I'm married. A failure.
But go check that out. That was the second anniversary episode. That
Generations.
Came out about a month ago, Generations. That's a really funny episode. Maybe funnier than any of these episodes we've counted down from on this.
Well, show. I don't know. Thomas Middleditch isn't in it. All right, that's
it. That's it. Is that the end enough. Of it?
That's the end of it.
All right.
It was fun.
It was fun.
I had a good time.
It was fun for a while.
Wow.
Paul, I want to thank you so much. I know you've been really busy lately and sick. you got a sinus infection. And
I did. Like at the tail end of the year, it kind of all caught up with me.
And we were traveling so much, and you've been filming a million episodes of Bajillion, and you've been working, and you've been doing your live Largo shows. And yet, and I know you've been you've been turning down stuff, and you've been and you've been saying, no, I can't do this. No, I can't do this. And yet you reached out to me and said, I still have been making time to do the best ofs.
Yes. This was something that I had just always factored into my calendar from, you know, it's
just one of those things.
Yes,
it's a tradition.
Thing, like, of course we're going to do that.
I enjoy it every year. I would rather not be doing this with anyone else. It's something that I look forward to every year, and I thank you so much for making time for it. For all of the guests on the show who have been on all year, I appreciate so much all of you donating your time to the show and your genius and coming out here and being super funny every week. And the show would not exist without any of you. For all of the engineers and staff here at Earwolf, aside from this,
with notable exceptions.
Notable exceptions. your hard work puts this show out once or twice a week, and you know, we get to record it and just like walk out the door, but these guys have to sit there and snip it together you know, for hours afterwards. So I really appreciate that. And most of all, the listeners, I can't believe we've been doing this almost 8 years now and people still give a shit. And not only that, but you know, we did this live tour to, I believe, 40,000 plus people came out to see us.
Wow.
So incredible. The fact that people listen to this every week and enjoy it and care enough to vote on the episodes and get wrapped up in what's going to be number one. And, you know, it's really meaningful to me that it still holds such a big place in not only people who and a lot of people write to me and say, I've been listening since the old days at the radio station, but also new listeners every year who are like, I just found out about this. How have I not listened to it? It's so gratifying and rewarding to hear from you all. Thank you so much. I really appreciate it. We could do the show without you listening, but why would we? We would just be recording it and putting it out. And then we'd look at the statistics and be like, no one's listening to this. We would stop.
It would be weird.
It'd be really weird.
It'd be weird.
But I'm not saying we wouldn't do it.
No, I'm sure we would.
Because we're insane.
We're mentally ill people.
We really are. And I, as previously established, have a learning disability.
That's right. I'm imaginary. So, Scott, may I say
yes.
to the listeners how much I appreciate the support that people have given me and the encouragement. And it is nice to know that it's that the stuff that I do is connecting with someone. And I'm so grateful to be able to be a part of this show in this family, and to work with the people that I've gotten to work with, make new friends, and do exciting creative things with people. That tour was so much fun.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I'm extremely...
And we had a lot of people from Bajillion on the show this year, whom we got to know because of Bajillion. Yeah. And people like, you know, Ryan and Drew and Tawny and Mandel and Tim and Dan. And have I left anyone out?
No, that's, I think...
Is that everybody?
Yeah.
You know, they've been on the show a lot this year. And it's really rewarding to keep meeting these new people and going, oh, wow, look at all these great improvisers, and then, bringing them into the fold. And then, you know, new people like Zeke and Jessica McKenna, and Rhea Butcher was on for the first time this year, you know, and has done three episodes. So it's great to have all these new people, and then our old favorites like Andy Daly and Nick Kroll, who have been on since the very beginning. It's really cool to be able to work with all these people over a long span of time.
Yeah. But thank you very much for having me be a part of this, because it means a great deal to me.
Of course. And thank you to the listeners. It means a lot. And hopefully you'll listen to us next year when we haven't promised to do another iRobot song, thank God, because that really came down to the wire. But we'll talk about Mr. Microphone.
Always. You can get, like clockwork, every year.
Please send us any Mr. Microphone minutia you have.
If you have any news, we need it.
Recent Mr. Microphone news. We'll see you next week on Monday with another one of our great traditions. We'll have another Ben Schwartz and Horatio Sanz episode. Looking forward to that. And who knows what 2017 will bring for us, not only personally, but for the show. Who knows? We'll see what we'll be counting down to come January. That's very exciting to me. Paul, thank you very much. And listeners, thank you very much. We'll see you on Monday. Thanks. Bye.